Hello and welcome to the Gran Turismo World Series World Finals, coming to you live from Monaco. Now, if you've only just joined us, you have missed some spectacular racing, as yesterday we crowned our Nations Cup regional champions. And these guys weren't the only winners yesterday. We also crowned our Michelin driver of the day, which was Coquer Lopez, who pulled up a spectacular medium accidental move that won in the entire race, which is pretty, pretty cool. Now, today is all about the Manufacturers' Cup, and if you're unclear as to how that sort of works, let's break down the comp format. All right, so we have got 12 teams of three drivers, and there's one driver basically from each of the regions, which I think makes it quite interesting in terms of like team dynamics. Now, they're going to have like a conversation about who's going to be the nominated driver with that pressure of that single lap qualifying, because that's going to, you know, determine the grid position for race one, which is obviously hugely important. And of course, all three drivers have the race at some point. I mean, that goes without saying. Race one, that's going to determine the grid position for the final race. And this is super important because obviously it's double points in the final race. So there's really everything to play for right up until the very, very last minute. Now, it's not going to be the winner of that final race who wins the whole thing. It's obviously the accrued points over the whole year. Oh, I don't know how it's going to go down, but we're sure as heck going to find out. I'm dead excited about today, and I know all of the drivers have been working so hard because they take such pride in this one. You're not going to want to miss it. I'm going to stop talking now, and I'm going to throw it over to Tom and Jimmy.
Thank you very much indeed, Julia. Welcome to Monaco. Welcome to the venue for the Manufacturers' Cup Grand Finals here for the 2022 GT World Series. My name's Tom Brooks. Alongside me, Jimmy Broadbent, JB. I mean, it's been an amazing year in the Manufacturers' Cup, and here is where we get to crown our champions.
Yeah, I always love the Manufacturers' Series. Proper teamwork required for this one, and a little bit of humility as well. Perhaps maybe if you're not as quick as your teammates.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, thanks very much. Let's have a look, shall we, at qualifying, which took place earlier on today. It was a single-lap shootout for all of our drivers and manufacturers. You can see Honda setting the early pace, but look here at Team Porsche. They had Jose Serrano behind the wheel, and he managed to get to the top of the timesheets. I think he was pretty happy and pretty surprised by that, Jimmy.
Talking of surprises, check out Nico Romero's reaction to finishing second in qualifying. He could hardly believe it. Jumped out of his seat there. Awesome job by them. Team VW looking very, very quick in the middle sector, but a small mistake in the last part of the lap saw them 2/10 off the fastest lap, and disappointment there for Suzuki.
Absolutely. Team Toyota were looking pretty handy. They could only manage to qualify second, though. Pretty happy, though, was Nikita Moisov, who was driving for the line in that one. You can see Team Porsche then will start on pole position for race one here today with Toyota alongside. Row two will be Genesis and Volkswagen. Then it's Mercedes and Subaru. Then Honda and Mazda, Lexus and BMW, Nissan and Team McLaren completing the 12-team strong grid. 36 drivers ready to take to the field for this one. It is going to be hugely exciting. And of course, it is a bit of a special weekend, a special year for Gran Turismo. It's the 25th anniversary. Can you believe it? So we're going to head on over to Yamauchi-san, the creator of Gran Turismo, for a few words before we get this underway.
今年25周年を、グランツリスモを迎えたわけですけれども、それもこれも、グランツリスモを支えてくださった、ユーザーの皆さん、それからグランツリスモに、関わってくださった様々な自動車メーカーをはじめとするパートナーの皆さん、それからメディアの皆さん、そして、グランツリスモの、日々のね、楽しさを、常にこうキープしてくれている、コミュニティの皆さんに改めて感謝をしたいと思います。
So we are celebrating our 25th anniversary this year, and it's really due to everyone who have supported Gran Turismo over the years, the users, the people of the automotive industry, all our partners, the media, and really people of the community who have continued to have fun playing Gran Turismo. And we are very thankful, and I'd like to show my appreciation to them.
あと、この 25年間、ずっとグランツーリスモを作り続けてきてくれた、ポリフォニーの、チームの、皆さんにも本当に、感謝の気持ちを伝えたいと思います。ありがとうございます。
And I'd like to also give my thanks to the Polyphony Digital team who have continued to work on the Gran Turismo series for the last 25 years. So thank you very much, everyone.
Well, Yamauchi-san, of course, it is 25 years since Gran Turismo began. Of course, it's 2 years, though, since we were last here in Monaco. So what were your thoughts on the first time you stepped into the venue here at Monaco after 2 years?
モナコから離れてもう2年間も経っちゃいましたけど、こうやってまたモナコでこうやってイベントを開催されて、会場に入った時、どのような感情が浮かび上がりましたか？
はい、ここにいらっしゃる皆さんは、コンペティターの皆さん、メディアの皆さんも含めて、本当にみんなグランツーリスモのファミリーなので、なんかこう、家に帰ってきたなっていう感じがしています。
Yeah, so everyone that's gathered here today, including all the competitors and all the everyone from the media, you know, we're all like a big family, so it's sort of like coming home for me.
Well, Yamauchi-san, of course, it is 25 years since Gran Turismo began. Can you just talk us through what the journey has meant to you so far?
Gran Turismo が始まってからこうやって25年も経ったわけですけど、これまでの旅、山内さんにとってどういった意味を持つ旅でしたか？
ですね、この25年の旅というのは、そうだな、グランツーリスモの成長の歴史でもあるんですけれども、同時にグランツーリスモのファミリーをどんどん世界中に広げていく、まあ、そういう旅でした。
Yeah, so the journey of the last 25 years, of course, is a journey of the growth of Gran Turismo, but at the same time, it has been a journey where the family of Gran Turismo has expanded.
Well, Yamauchi-san, thank you very much indeed for those very kind words. We're, of course, supremely grateful for 25 years of Gran Turismo, not only to the staff here in the venue and for those who have made it happen, but also to you at home as well. And we're giving you an opportunity to say thanks, really, for being a part of the journey in Gran Turismo by giving you some special campaign moments to enjoy in GT7.
If you have opened up GT7 in the past couple of days, you will see that it has been updated for the World Finals. We're celebrating Gran Turismo's 25th anniversary in style. And if you enter the 25th anniversary races, you will be gifted a X2019 in a stunning special livery. You can also get closer to the action by competing in the exact same races as our 2022 World Finals drivers. If you think you can predict who will be our 2022 world champions, click on the bonus campaign for your chance to win credits. And if you're watching our streams, then click on the viewers campaign within the next 24 hours for your chance to win by answering a question you can only know the answer to if you're watching. See you in GT7.
Well, I think that's pretty exciting, don't you? Some great opportunities for everybody at home to enjoy GT7. But of course, we've got racing action to happen here this evening as well with the Manufacturers' Cup. 36 drivers, 12 manufacturers. Let's meet them now, shall we? First up, let's go for Team McLaren. Their driver lineup is comprised of Greece's Konstantinos Konstantinou, Japan's Hayato Imazato, and the USA's Ethan Lim. Team BMW, a German manufacturer, but a very varied lineup. Jose Breyer from Spain, Yuki Kadaka from Japan, and the USA's Randall Haywards. Lexus won the inaugural manufacturer's title back in 2018. Their driver lineup here today is comprised of Belgium's Quintenia Hall, the USA's Donovan Parker, and Japan's Kanata Kawakami. Honda have got 2021 Nations Cup champion Valerio Gallo, Brazil's Raul Pessoa, and Matt McEwen from New Zealand. T Team Porsche will start the first race on pole position. Their driver lineup is comprised of Chile's Angel Inostroza, Spain's Jose Serrano, and Japan's Takuma Sasaki. Newcomers to the Manufacturers Cup in 2022 Genesis have got Japan's Yuito Sasaki, Nico Romero from Spain, and Dean Helt from the USA as their driver lineup. Volkswagen have got Thomas Lebusole, Saya Suzuki, and Roberto Sternberg. Team Nissan have Argentina's Mateo Estevez, Mehdi Hafidi from France, and Japan's Hiroshi Okamoto. Team Mazda will have Suko Nabatani, Giorgio Mangano, and Canada's Andrew Brooks at the helm. Mercedes-AMG have got Lucas Benelli from Brazil, Baptiste Beauvoir from France, and Japan's Shinsuke Sobi. Mm-hmm. 2020 Manufacturers Champions, Subaru have got Kilian Drummond from France, Danny Solis from the USA, and Japan's Takuma Miyazono as their driver lineup. And last but not least, we welcome Team Toyota from the Czech Republic, Nikita Moisov, from Japan, Ryota Kokoban, and from Brazil, it is Igor Fraga. And before we get racing underway, your respect please now for the national anthem of our host nation here in Monaco. Well, it is so wonderful to have so many people here. It is time, though, to begin the Manufacturers' Cup Finals here in Monaco for 2022. A big hello from wherever you are joining us from in the world. Welcome to Monaco for the 2022 Manufacturers Cup Finals here. And we are ready to get racing action underway. We are, of course, live, not only in English, but in seven different languages. We've got the German commentators there. It's Mikkel and Florian. They're joined by Mikael Azal, the 2019 champion. France have got Donald and Fabian. We've got Spain with Lucas and Alberto, the ever-passionate Italians with Emilio and Andrea, the Portuguese lineup of Duarte and Francisco, then the Japanese contingents of Yamada-san and Nakajima-san. I mean, you couldn't ask for more, could you, really?
No, I mean, we could, but we don't. We spoil you guys at home. It's awesome to have the stream be so accessible across the world. And of course, but you know, English stream is best stream. Just going to put that.
Well, of course, we need to talk you through what has happened so far in the season to date in the Manufacturers Cup. So let's run you through the points that have been accrued over the course of the year so far. Team Toyota, Team Subaru, Jimmy, tied at the top on 10.
Yeah, going to make it very interesting for the race. It basically means whoever performs better here today is going to come out on top. And of course, Mercedes, AMG, Mazda, Nissan and Volkswagen still there, close, still with points as well. Porsche, Honda, Lexus, BMW and McLaren get to thoughts so far, but there are a lot of points up for grabs today.
Yeah, there certainly are. We're very much looking forward to seeing how those points are going to look like. Let's head down to Julia, though, because she's got some big news for us about Dior.
Yes, now you might remember that we announced in Salzburg the beautiful Christian Dior virtual capsule that you could get with in-game, obviously the shoes, the suit, and the helmet as well. And Christian Dior thought it would be rather special, you know, for the world finals to actually take some time and to create these beautiful pieces designed by Kim Jones into real life. Look, they're right here. I want to talk you through a little bit about like some of the design aspects of the whole outfit, because honestly, they've spent so much time and like hundreds of hours creating this. So you can see from the suit, actually, if you kind of zoom in, you see here, you have the Christian Dior diamond here. You have obviously the number 47, which is a hugely important number for Christian Dior because it's the year that the Maison was founded and their first runway show as well. So it's a huge meaning for the entire company. And then you see here the pattern, the Dior oblique, which you can see actually runs through all of the whole, everything really, from the shoes to the suit. To my favorite bit, I have to say, which is on the visor here of the helmet, you can see it's beautifully replicated and it looks pretty spectacular. They actually told me as well that the entire helmet is hand-painted. I don't know how they did that. That's kind of amazing, but it's absolutely beautiful and just stunning to kind of see it in real life. I'm not sure if I can take it home with me. Probably not, but I will ask because it's kind of cool. They're also going to be showing a video at youtube.com/Dior about just how they created these beautiful pieces, which will be available after the show, so you can head on over to YouTube. But I think now we should start getting this first race underway. What do you think, Tom and Jimmy?
I think you're absolutely spot on there, Julia. Let's have a look, shall we, at the starting lineup for race one. So we saw qualifying a few moments ago. Team Porsche starting on pole with Team Toyota, Team Genesis, then Volkswagen, AMG, Mercedes in P5, Subaru P6, Honda in 7th, then Mazda, Lexus, BMW, Nissan, and McLaren down in 12th place. And, well, we're keeping an eye on Toyota because, of course, they are the reigning champions, Jimmy, and this is the GR Super Racing concept.
Yeah, current joint leaders as well. We've raced this car, of course, the other day in the TGT Cup. But it's great to see it here again. Just under 600 horsepower, of course. Group 3 style regulation. So lots of aero, lots of downforce there. Of course, FR drivetrain as well, meaning driven from the rear wheels. Awesome car to drive. And the circuit they're going to be on today is the Deep Forest Raceway, but reversed, because why not?
I love the creativity that Polyphony come up with for these events. We saw the Deep Forest Raceway back at round 3 of the World Series. Now we're doing it in the other direction. And if round 3 was anything to go by, it was chaos. So looking forward to this one. Hard, medium, soft tyres available. You can see there each tyre type must be used for a minimum of 6 laps over the 20-lap race duration. But with time 6 tyre wear there, JB, I'm keen to see what the strategies are going to play out like.
Yeah, we've seen these new soft tyres be very difficult to get a handle on over the last couple of events, over the last couple of days. So these guys have been here for that duration. They'll know exactly what to expect there as well. So hopefully that information will be in their head. Of course, remember you can vote for your Michelin driver of the day on #GT7, #GT World Series. We'll announce that a bit later on.
Absolutely. Of course, all three drivers must take part in this race from the different manufacturers. So they've now got their starting driver in the grid. Here's a look at what we're expecting the strategy to be like. If you start on the softs, you'll do it for 6 laps, 7 laps on the medium, 7 laps on the hards, and then you can see the different variations depending on where they start, Jimmy.
Yeah, reminder, of course, you have to use every tyre for a minimum of 6 laps. So A lot of the drivers thinking basically it's going to be 8 laps on the soft and the rest of the tyres are like lava. But also, just to inform you that when you do come into the pit lane to change tyres, you do have to change driver as well. That is a requirement. So matching up the tyre stint to the driver, very important.
You can see the tyre differential in terms of pace there. Medium's about 7/10 of a second slower. Hard's 1.6 seconds slower. So again, very keen to see what exactly is going to happen. But tension is in the air. We're ready to get the first race for the world final of the Manufacturers Cup underway here in Monaco. So then the drivers and the teams line up on the grid. It'll be Team Porsche that start from pole position. Team Toyota with Ryota Kokkonen behind the wheel heads the second place on the grid. Row two with Genesis. Then we've got Volkswagen heading on the outside of the second row. Then it is Team Mercedes with Lucas Benelli behind the wheel. Team Subaru, the 2020 champions, Takuma Miyazono, one of the drivers who brought that manufacturer to the top, lining up P6. Then it is Honda in seventh place. Mazda in eighth position with the Vision Gran Turismo Group 3 machine. Lexus, 2018 champions, line up P9 with BMW down in 10th place on the grid. P11 is Team Nissan with the Nismo GTR. And then McLaren, the British manufacturer, bookending the 12-driver strong field. Interestingly, no manufacturers opting to start on the soft tyres, all going for a mixture of mediums and hards.
No, it seems at the moment they're maybe saving that soft tyre for the middle or last stint. I think they might be a bit more useful at that point in the race. But a lot of the drivers at the front going for the medium compounds. So we're used to seeing, just trying for a quick first stint there with towards the back of the field going for that hard tyre stint. Getting out of the way nice and quickly before they go on to faster tyres from there. But Cabrera's now getting ready for what's going to be, I'm sure, an awesome race.
Well, Team Toyota have taken 2 Manufacturers Cup wins so far in 2022. The other 2 belong to Subaru. Will it be a Japanese squabble at the front, or will we see Porsche, who of course start this race on pole position, prevailing? We're about to find out over the course of this 20-lap race at Deep Forest Raceway in reverse. 3 drivers to take to the race for the different manufacturers, 36 in total, 12 manufacturers, and here we are, ready to get race 1 of the Manufacturers Cup World Finals underway here in Monaco. It's Team Porsche that lead the field down towards the first corner, followed by Team Toyota, then Team Genesis. Of course, we're running this circuit in reverse, so the first part of the circuit becomes quite an open, flowing element, really, and this is going to be really interesting to see how it works out before we head into the first big braking zone of the hairpin. And you can see there, Volkswagen already coming under pressure from Mercedes AMG. They're going for the defensive and actually on the attack, as it turns out, on Genesis. It's all getting a bit rough and tumble in the mid part of the first couple of corners, but we ride on board here with Mercedes. They started fifth, they still sit in fifth.
Yeah, good start from McLaren there, from the back of the field up to P9 already. That Subaru, though, struggling a little bit in the straight line down here. Honda right up behind it. We're on board with the Mercedes AMG right now. First big braking zone. VW goes lunging up the inside of the Genesis, and they slow down on the apex. Contact there between the Mercedes and Volkswagen and Genesis, from what I can see, if had an incident, been shuffled down massively, because they're now showing down as 8th place, so I think they must have hit the wall.
Yeah, I think you're quite right. Yeah, clearly contact there has not helped them out at all. Here is Mercedes, Lucas Benelli starting this race for the German manufacturer, right up the gearbox of the Volkswagen team then, as they come through the mid part of this circuit, very much one at a time as you go through here. You can see the incident under investigation on that first lap between Mercedes and Genesis, so the steward's going to be reviewing that corner by corner. You can see Lucas Benelli really trying to close up onto the back of the Volkswagen. Thomas Laboussole, the Frenchman, behind the wheel, but also it's allowing Subaru to close up as well. Takuma Miyazono fancies a slice of the pie here too.
Yeah, so a lot of stuff under investigation at the moment, so we'll get onto that as soon as we know what the results are. Mercedes looking to the outside here of BWC. That Subaru in a straight line is absolutely nowhere, but under braking in the corners, it can close right up. Loads of downforce on that thing. Going to one of the big braking zones now. Good place to lunge here, if you're feeling like a bit of a move, but not quite close enough. It's Mercedes at the moment in the background. Honda squabbling with Mazda as well. But a decent start here from VW. Toyota, though, in front of us, putting away, as are Porsche.
Nissan have made a pretty good start to this race as it stands, sitting there in 9th position on the medium combat of tyres. Here we go, side by side with Mercedes versus Volkswagen. Then so it's Benelli versus Laboutelé. Up the inside goes Lucas Benelli, and he goes through into 3rd place at the hairpin. Need to keep an eye out as well for Takuma Miyazono in the Subaru, very close behind, because these 3 drivers all running nose to tail. This is going to get pretty interesting. Let's have another look at that incident down into the hairpin here, Jimmy.
Yeah, here we are, VW on the inside. Genesis gets punted big time by Mercedes there, as then sideways across the circuit. That is...
Yeah, I don't think we can repeat. I don't think we can repeat what he said there.
I think that's why it was in slow-mo. I think so, but yeah, Nicky Romero, understandably not happy at that. I mean, that's a slam dunk for me. That was just a smash and run there from Benelli in the Mercedes. Stewart's still looking at that, though, at the moment, so we'll wait for their say-so before we go on from there. But at the moment, Porsche still leading. We're on board now with Subaru. We'll get an idea of the power difference between the two cars. Look at this. VW in front of us. We're in the tow, and we're being gapped at the moment by the VW in front. But watch us into the braking zone. To come and be a zone at the wheel. We know how capable of a driver he is. So let's watch him into this braking zone through the left-hander, heavy on the brakes, and just like that, he's right back on the back of them once again. So power isn't everything here in this race.
No, that Subaru, the BOP has been slightly adjusted. Penalty there, 2 seconds for Mercedes-AMG. You said it was a slam dunk, Jimmy, and 2 seconds is really going to compromise their race, especially given it's so early because the field is so close together.
Yeah, I would actually give more than that, I think. It was a proper big hit, that. But, yeah, 2 second penalty, definitely worthy though of the crime there. Mercedes-AMG are going to serve that coming up to the next penalty zone, which actually is, they have to go around a whole other lap before they can get that to the back straight here. So here's the replay from the perspective, sorry, of Mercedes, VW up the inside, and then just, I don't know, just it doesn't really, just doesn't acknowledge the existence of the Genesis, just drives into it like it isn't there. Such a weird one.
Yeah, the gap was always going to disappear, wasn't it? And whether he just outbraked himself and decided to use him as a bit of a boat anchor, either way, it has really compromised the driver of the Mercedes, which is Lucas Benelli, and of course compromised the rest of the team for the strategy of that race, because after this penalty is served, they will fall behind Volkswagen, they will fall behind Subaru, and it's going to put them closer to Honda, who are in sixth place. And I have to say, Honda doing a really good job in the early stages of this one here, Jimmy. Matt McEwen behind the wheel of this one, and BMW picking up a 2 second penalty here too.
Yeah, I didn't actually see what that one was for. We might get a replay of that at some point, but still a 2 second penalty. To be fair to them, it's not going well anyway. They're off the back by about five or about a second. So meanwhile, Genesis trying to make their way back through the field here, through Honda and through Nissan there. Two wide behind Genesis, they're leading this little pack. And Nissan just about tucks back in behind the Genesis, but Honda there looking very, very feisty at this point. A Subaru ahead goes ahead of Mercedes after serving their penalty.
So teams that have had a good start to this race include Volkswagen, Subaru and Nissan. They've been up 1-2 and 4 places respectively. Bad start to the race, as we know, for Genesis, down 3 positions from where they started. We look at them now, they have got Nissan breathing down their neck, and not too far adrift is Honda as well. Honda were doing a good job. They were up there in 6th place just a few moments ago, have now been overtaken by Genesis and in turn Nissan too.
Yeah, they are on that hard tyre there, Tom, so on the hard runners they are kind of leading that second pack. Genesis has done a good job of coming back through. Nissan, of course, as well, starting from P11 on the grid, plus 4 right now. And Genesis have been given a 1 second penalty for driving dangerously post-incident. Now, we didn't see the full replay there. We saw him get biffed. We didn't see him come back on. So this is the replay of BMW and their penalty. Let's see what they did to him. Going to go up the inside of Lexus. A little bit of contact there. Round goes Lexus. So, it's a shame there. That was a very messy first lap.
Yuki Kodaka, who was behind the wheel, that was going in towards that hairpin. Of course, the first real opportunist braking zone on the circuit, and drivers just getting a little bit too eager. Maybe cold tyres and cold brakes not helping them at all. So here is the 1 second penalty that Genesis have got, and they will have to serve that. They will then, of course, fall behind Nissan and possibly into the clutches of Honda and Mazda, who are not too... Oh, sorry, Nissan. I don't know if Honda and Mazda, I was right initially, who are not too far adrift. Here we are, ready to serve that penalty here for Genesis then. So it's going to be into the penalty zone. They move off the racing line very sensibly, allowing them to go through and look at side-by-side further back between Honda and Mazda here too as they come through the tunnel then. We look at Nissan, who are up the road in sixth place, but is all kicking off very close behind. As you can see, Porsche now coming under a bit more threat here from Team Toyota. So Kockerman, who is behind the wheel of that Toyota, seems to be getting his rhythm in after a few laps here now and is right on the gearbox of the Porsche.
Yeah, really, really good performance so far from the top two drivers here. We thought not really giving them much attention, but they've just pulled away from the pack. But they've been clever. They're kind of working together a bit here in this early stage. The gap is still half a second. You see the live point rankings as they stand in the race finished right now. Of course, we still have 15 laps of racing left and several pit stops. Now, interestingly, Tom, we are coming up now to lap 6, and we think we're going to see the probably first of the pit stops. What we think we're going to see, what I think we're going to see, is the teams do both 6 laps on the medium and the hard, and then do that 8 laps there on that soft tyre and really make the best use of that tyre. So we're on board still with the Toyota as we chase the Porsche up the hill. I've got to say, the reverse version of this circuit, this circuit's kind of mad anyway, but the reverse version, that massive uphill climb towards the first hairpin, it's solid, isn't it? All right.
It was funny, because we were talking earlier, you said, oh, actually, who goes and paints the grid slots for this reverse layout instead of the forward layout?
But I think there's probably someone down there in the polyphony zone. It's their job to turn the grid slots around for this. So
out there with a big paintbrush. That's yeah. Looking here at Subaru, then, all over the back of Volkswagen, and Holland picking up a penalty there. Absolutely what that's all about. There was nothing under investigation, so we assume that is track limits for the time being. Behind the wheel of that Honda at the moment is João Pessoa, the Brazilian driver, so let's see whether that is going to compromise their race. They are now a second behind Mazda, despite being really close to them just a couple of laps ago, and that's going to really drop them off the back.
Watch this Subaru in this sector. It is so fast through here. There's so much aero on this car, but when we get to the straight, it just hasn't quite got the straight lines. We haven't got the same power as the cars in front. In some cases, it's about 100 horsepower down on some of the cars, but just because it has that amount of sheer amount of aero and the mechanical grip, it's able to close back up again. Now, we're on board with Subaru and Volkswagen, both coming over to the right-hand side of the circuit, as are Mercedes, all pitting in on lap six for the soft compound of Michelin tyres. So everyone diving into the pits now. You can see driver changes there happening in the bottom left-hand corner of your screen. The guys are fitted with team radios. They can talk to each other back on the sort of virtual pit wall we have here at Gran Turismo and decide when is the best time to come in. So into the car now for the soft compound. Who is that Porsche there in the car now, Tom?
Into the Porsche is Angel Estrosa. So he's the driver who set pole positions. He's really quick in this car over the course of one lap. We know he's very quick in racing conditions. We saw that yesterday by being crowned the America's regional final champion. Interesting though, Jimmy, I was going to say about the strategy. Porsche have gone to the soft tyre. Toyota, who are in second or were in second, have gone to the hard tyre. So alternate strategies here.
And that's Igor Fraga in the car there on the hard compound tyre. So what I'm thinking is they're going, right, we'll put Fraga in. Fraga's a very safe pair of hands in the Toyota. He's driven the car for a long time. And probably just thinking, right, damage limitation. Let's lose as little time as possible on that hard compound tyre so we can go quick a bit later on. Team Subaru still out on the circuit. Well, they're out right now, sorry, just behind VW on that soft compound tyre. Let's see what they can do from here. This is going to be their fast in for Subaru. See what sort of times they can do.
What we should expect here from Porsche is to go for as long as they can on this soft compound tyre. So this is going to alternate the strategies, as we said, not only in terms of their pace, but Porsche will go for as long as they can in this middle stint. Toyota, they're probably going to go for the minimum time, 6 laps on that hard tyre. That's the minimum time they have to do. So they'll be coming into the pits at a different time to Porsche. So it's going to work out really interestingly at the end of this race. This and Genesis into the pits. They're the only runners who have not yet made their pit stops. They're going on to the hard tyre. So that's going to affect release the rest of the field back into the order that it was before the pit stops took place. And you can see three drivers here running nose to tail with one another. That is Toyota, who've got Volkswagen right up their trumpet, followed by Subaru. And of course, Toyota on the back foot here, really, because they've got two soft shot machines very close behind. And I wonder how good Igor Fraga's defensive driving is going to be here.
If Igor can keep him there, that's fantastic. As long as he doesn't lose too much time defending, that's amazing. People are saying that he's gone wide coming up through the hairpin there, which has allowed VW onto the inside here. Next corner is a right hander, and VW does seem to have the legs in a straight line over Toyota. It's very, very close as Toyota now starts to show its top speed. But VW back into the slipstream. Are we going to see a dive here up the inside? There must surely be one. Up the inside there goes the VW on the Toyota. A little bit of contact as he tries to get the undercut. It's Suzuki currently in the Volkswagen at the moment. He qualified the car, had that small mistake, of course, in the last sector. So maybe trying to make up for that now. And Fraga goes wide. Is he pushed wide there by the Subaru driver? I'm not sure. But that was Drummond there. No, sorry, it wasn't Drummond.
It was Drummond,
in the Supers. So I think he might have had contact.
Yeah, let's see whether we get a replay of that. So Kilian Drummond either got his elbows out or Igor Fraga made a bit of a mistake. It's an interesting area to go and do that. The upshot is that it's now the three soft shot runners who are at the helm of this race, followed by then the hard runners of Toyota, Mercedes, Nissan and Genesis under investigation for colliding with another car, Subaru versus Toyota. So clearly there was contact between those two drivers. And that's going to be really interesting if they are awarded the penalty. Meanwhile, come back to that thought in a few moments' time, because Genesis on the hard tyres are being chased down by the soft shot Mazda, the medium shot Mazda, I should say. In the slipstream comes the Mazda then, and they're going to pull out of the slipstream in towards the right hand. They have more grip in the middle of the corner. Subaru awarded with a 1 second penalty as Mazda elevate themselves up to P6.
Now, it's going to be quite big for Subaru, of course. They take a long time to get up to speed, does that car. The penalty zone is pretty much right here where we're watching the cars go through now, so that's going to be a big time loss. We're going to get a replay and see what happened there. So we're on board with the Subaru now. We're going to monitor the wheel. Yeah, just a little bit. I think maybe not quite anticipating the fact that the Toyota there is on the slower tyre. We know that car's quick in a straight line, or sorry, quick in the corners is the Subaru. So, I think just a little bit of miscommunication there.
That's unfortunate for Kilian Drumont, and Subaru is going to give a fair bit of work for Danny Solis to do once he takes over or behind the wheel of that car. Currently sitting in third place, but possibly going to be set to lose out here. Warning there for Lexus for colliding with another car. They're down in P11, having a bit of a dog's day at the office so far. Of course, we saw the strife that they were in the opening stages after that contact with BMW on the opening lap, and it just goes from bad to worse there for them if they are awarded a penalty. We'll see what the stewards do decide. So across the timing line come Volkswagen and Subaru. Porsche are clearing off at the moment. They've got 4.3 seconds over the rest of the field. Angel Estrosa is putting in some brilliant laps behind the wheel of that one. At 123.8 it was last time around. Compare that to the other soft shot cars at 24.1 for Volkswagen, 24.2 for Subaru. So he's a few tenths of a second faster already.
Yeah, we know this about Angel. You put him at the head of a race, you put him on a soft compound tyre, he'll just rock it away. It's his favourite place to be on the circuit. So Subaru there serving the penalty they've got for the contact with Toyota, and now has to try and make up that time lost. And of course, all the way down the straight, he's going to lose that time. You can see currently what the points available are for this race. 12 points for a win in race one. That's then doubled to 24 points in the grand final. So even if you have a bad race one here, you can still come back if you have a good grand final race.
Yeah, there are still plenty of opportunities. We're out the half distance in this race, then the first one of the Manufacturers' Cup World Finals. Look at McLaren, a lunge to the inside, into the hairpin. It's a day later, the dollar short though. Honda back up the inside as McLaren running a bit deep. I mean, they've had a tricky day at the office with difficult qualifying at the back of the grid for this first race. Now they're trying to make forward progress behind the wheel of the McLaren at the moment.
It's contact
there, as you say, in the mid part of the circuit, and just about managing to keep it facing in the right direction. Thankfully, not too much harm done.
A bit cheeky there, but if it wasn't, you can't just drive through the guy in front, for crying out loud. He's there. He occupies space. You can't just drive into him. But regardless, coming now to the last corner. Nissan in front, a little bit wide on the way in. There's a bit of a late apex, this one. So turn in late and then full gas all the way down the straight. Now we're on board the McLaren. We're sitting behind the Honda, so we're in the slipstream. We're getting a little bit more straight line speed. You now see we're creeping up to the back of the rear wing, getting ever closer and closer. We're going to now try and go up the inside. Ethan Lim now at the wheel of the McLaren. We're going to try and go. He's on the inside now, so we have the inside line for the hairpin here. Through he goes on the Honda, but there might be a little bit of a warning handed out there for that little bit of a biff. There it is. There you go. Prophetic. I've done it, finally.
Have you got the lottery numbers for Saturday, Jimmy?
So not McLaren. For you, mate.
McLaren, Ethan Lim up into eighth place. So Matt McEwen defenceless despite his best efforts. Genesis having been awarded a penalty in sixth place again as well. So that's been, the second penalty that they've received here in this race. I think that might be for track limits because we didn't see a graphic flash up on the screen. And we'll be keen to see what that is going to affect their race. If it's a half-second penalty, it won't be too much of a drama because they're already 8 seconds off the back of Mercedes, who are in fifth place, and 2 seconds or so just ahead of Nissan in seventh. On board we ride here though with Matt McEwen, and instead of it being a duo of drivers fighting for position, it's set to become a trio here because slowly, step by step, they've been closing up onto the back of the hard shot Nissan.
Nissan at the moment struggling a bit on this hard compound attire. They haven't quite got the pace we saw at the start. Of course, they were on a quicker tire at the start, but it hasn't been a good start for Team Nissan. But I think overcoming starting 10th on the grid has been a little bit too much for them.
So down the start finish straight they go. Let's see whether this is going to be a move that is made down to the first corner. Of course, the slipstream is effective there for McLaren. The hole is being pushed in the air in front of them, and then Nissan, I think, are going to be a bit powerless here to try to bend. They're going to try into the left-hander. So trying to squeeze the McLaren there was the Nissan of who's behind the wheel of that one. Estevez, unfortunately, and he just pushed himself too close to the inside, and now you can see Honda trying to get themselves involved in the action as well, and that has cost Nissan very dearly indeed, I'm afraid to say. They have gone right to the back of the field.
It's just unnecessary. you don't need to be racing each other that close on lap 12, but we'll see a replay of it. We'll see what happened there. And unfortunately for Team Mister, that day goes from bad to, well, this has ended. It's done. There's no way they're coming back from this. But we're still watching now, still watching McLaren. We'll see what happened with them.
We've lost Mazda from the race, Jimmy. Something's happening to them because they've dropped off the bottom of the timing screen.
Oh, no.
11 manufacturers.
I wonder where the... I thought it was 12. I wonder where they went.
Yeah, that's such a disappointment there for Mazda. We can only assume it's a technical problem that has robbed them of the opportunity. And we're looking here in the venue where we can see that it is indeed a technical problem with their rig. It happens in real life. It happens here in sim racing as well. And it has really, unfortunately, thrown them out of any meaningful contention for this one.
Yeah, real shame for them, but we've had a, horrible to have another issue like that for Team Mazda, but the grand final is still there. There are still double points on offer for there, so it isn't over for them yet. Now, Team Toyota, Eagle Frogger comes into the pit lane, goes onto the soft compound of tyre, and that's going to be Nikita Moisov now in the car, who qualified the car, and did a fairly good job. I mean, I looked at their team lineup earlier on, and I thought Nikita Moisov might be the slowest driver there, but that's, you know, That's not a bad thing at all, you know. Like, I think they're all very, very equal. But he comes out just ahead of Team BMW there, which is good. Not because they're fighting with BMW, but because now he has lots of free air in front of him. The car in front is a Lexus. He's on the soft compound of tyre. He's going to drive into that gap now and really put the pressure on Team Porsche. At the front, by the way, Team Porsche have increased the lead, to nearly 5 seconds. That's Angelin Estrosa at the wheel there, but the tyres are starting to get into their shelf life, so I expect to see him in on the next lap.
Yeah, we're expecting 6 laps or so there and thereabouts on the medium or the hard compound of tyres, and we're coming right into that window now. So Porsche have tried to extend that soft tyre for as long as they can.
Well, it's 6 laps minimum, so they have to come in next lap. There's no question about that there.
Yeah, of course. So Porsche, Volkswagen, Subaru will be into the pits very shortly. We've had the last pit stops being made for Toyota, for Mercedes and for Honda as it stands. And I have to say, this is working out quite nicely so far here for Team Toyota. They've got Nikita Moisov behind the wheel, who Jimmy said just a few moments ago, of course, managed to get that car on to the front row of the grid. Genesis and McLaren also into the pits. Soft tyres there for McLaren for their final stint. Genesis also opting for the same strategy. And likewise, Lexus BMW coming into the pit lane at the end of lap 13. So now it is all about Nikita Moisov and that soft tyre to see what he is going to be able to do, to see whether he can use that tyre advantage, use that clear air to close the deficit down to Team Porsche once the German manufacturer makes their final pit stop in this race.
You're going to watch out now for the soft runners. They're going to be really fast at the end of this race. If you saved the hard tyre until last, you're going to be the one that's vulnerable. So we'll keep an eye out. There's Team BMW coming out of the pit lane. Not been a good start for them, unfortunately. A big penalty earlier on and a spin means they are somewhat out of contention here, but still in the race and going to be in it to win it, so we'll keep an eye on them, see if they can improve from there. Porsche are still leading, just coming around the final corner now, and we expect him coming to pit lane. Yes, they do. Angelin Estrosa, after an awesome middle stint there on the soft tyre, comes into the pit lane, and he'll be handing over to Sasaki there for the last stint. So on that hard compound of tyre, now Sasaki is basically going to go backwards on this stint, so what he needs to have hoped is that Inestros has built up enough of a gap.
Well, it was 4.8 seconds coming into the pit lane, the advantage that they had. But, of course, as you say, Jimmy, Toyota are going to be on that soft tyre. They're going to be a lot quicker. So the last three pit stops take place. Porsche, Volkswagen and Subaru, their last driver change. And now we're coming right into the business end of this one. So 5 laps remain here at Deep Forest Raceway. 12 points up for grabs for the winner. And, of course, they've accrued World Series points over the course of this year as well. So they will want as good an opportunity as they can. So Porsche emerge from the pit lane. They sit in the race lead, 5.6 seconds ahead of Volkswagen, 2.7 of Volkswagen in front of Subaru. Toyota have got a bit of a mountain to climb here in P4.
I think Inestrosa's middle stint might have just won Porsche this race. I mean, bear in mind, Volkswagen and Subaru are both on that hard compound behind, so the pace differential isn't going to be that big. But Subaru, despite having a tyre that's about 1.6 seconds a lap quicker, has to get by Subaru, has to get by Volkswagen, and then catch and pass Porsche all in 5 laps.
Yeah, it's 12 seconds the gap at the moment, and unless, well, if he happens to the top three, or indeed if the Kington boys office eating his Weetabix this morning, I think he's still going to be in with a bit of a hard charge to try and do that. We look here at McLaren, they're 1 second to the bad of Honda, who sits in seventh place. Konstantinou at the helm of that machine. Good to see the Greek driver back in competition. We saw him last year, I think it was at the Olympic Virtual Series, actually, the last time we saw Konstantinos, and good to see him ripping that machine and doing a good job out there chasing down that Honda. The question is, can he find his way through?
We'll have to wait and see, won't we? That's a big thing about this. He is catching, as you say, in about a second now. He'll start getting the draft going down the straight as well. And it's such a long straight up towards that first massive braking zone here that if you have any sort of straight line speed advantage, or if you have the tow in front, you really feel that here. So McLaren only about a second and a bit behind. You'll just be starting to feel the first parts of the draft now. And that McLaren seems to be fairly quick in the straight line anyway. So all good there for Team McLaren. Meanwhile, Subaru and Toyota now getting close together. Subaru, of course, on that harder compound attire. Maybe it's time now for a bit of payback here for Team Toyota. Of course, we had Drew Bond give Fraga a bit of a biff. Now maybe it's time for Moisov to give who's that solace in the car a little bit of a biff there. So McLaren, 2 second penalty, and Toyota up the inside. Decisive move there at the inside of Team Subaru, up into third place. Now, can they catch Volkswagen? 3 seconds to the gap.
Absolutely. Well, of course, there are still points on offer for first, second, third, and all the way down. So they want to accrue as many points as they possibly can. If second is going to be the best opportunity that Team Toyota will get, it will be where they qualify, where they will finish, and it will be a very welcome result for them because, of course, they were tied on points coming into this event here too.
Toyota are charging, though. They are, they've done the fastest lap of the race, a 23.7 on that last lap there. Of course, this lap will probably be a bit slower due to the overtake, but they're looking very, very quick indeed. In fact, 2 seconds quicker than the Porsche on the last time around. So on that pace, they might actually get there. It'll be close, but they might just make it. And Moisov now really got his head down, really is trying to bring that gap down as quick as possible. In the background, Mercedes also gets by Subaru. Now, this is terrible for Subaru. Subaru and Toyota are currently joined on points at the moment at the top of the standings. Of course, every point they lose to Team Toyota is another point behind going into the grand final. But if you're Porsche right now, you're happy, you're sitting pretty.
Well, the one crumb of comfort they can take is, of course, in these double points for the grand final there for Subaru, but they need to try and hang on to the coattails of Mercedes if they can possibly do so. But it is going to be a hard old task given the lack of straight line speed that we've seen that BRZ suffer from this year, and of course the fact that they are on the hard tyres relative to those around them being on the soft. Just to give you an idea of the difference in pace between Porsche, who lead this race, 125.8 it was last time around for Porsche. For Toyota, a 124.3, so there's 8.1 seconds separating them. Three laps now remaining, and I think it's going to be too much of a hard task to challenge for the race lead, but I think second place is definitely on the cards, and you can see that gap visibly closing here.
Yeah, if you're in the VW right now, you are panicking. You're like, oh no, get away from me, get away. But there's not much you can do on that hard compound tyre. The difference, I mean, we see it. It's more like it's in braking, it's in traction, mid-corner, everywhere you're slower. So all it takes is for Toyota to get there. We might see some defensive driving from Team VW, but I'm not sure it's going to be enough. It's two and a bit laps left now for VW to try and defend this. I don't think they're going to be able to do it, Tom.
No, I think you could be quite right. Well, Roberto Sternberger is behind the wheel of that Volkswagen, behind the wheel of Toyota, as we know, is the Czech driver Nikita Moisov, and it is really all to play for. Very deep on the brakes. There goes Roberto Sternberger.
He's on the handbrake there, in the way.
He did. He must have adjusted the brake fires or something like that. Through the tunnel they go then. You can see, of course, the hole being pushed in the air in front for Toyota, unlike Roberto Sternberger in the Volkswagen. We know that Toyota is a bit of a missile in a straight line here, and he's closing onto the back, into the right hand. There's a lunge on the brakes here for Nikita Moisov. The gap was always going to disappear there, and he has to back out of it at the last moment, but he's really signalling his intentions here in the middle part of this lap. There's two to go at the end of this one, and it's the battle for second place that is really hotting up here between Volkswagen and Toyota, and it's a matter of time. Here comes Volkswagen, here comes Team Toyota up the inside of the German manufacturer, and they go through, and keep an eye out behind because Mercedes could be ready to shuffle Volkswagen off the podium here too.
Yeah, that was actually disastrous for Toyota. They got caught there behind VW, and that allowed Mercedes AMG behind to get that a little bit closer. We're going to see a big dive, I think, coming up soon. Maybe not, no. Maybe the Merc driver is thinking about trying to stay in that toe in the slipstream. It's Baptiste Provost. We know how fast he's in this car. He's been driving this car for a long time now. and he's going to just, I think, try and draft by VW and then get it. Oh, a little bit of contact there. That would have slowed up a little bit. He's going to try and go up the inside here, try and get the move made, and then he'll have just only a lap and a bit to try and get by Toyota. But up the hill there, you see the Mercedes struggling on speed. Contact there between the two of them. It's side by side, door banging up into the hair, but Mercedes AMG late on the brakes, both wide, gets the move done. And now, does he know? Sternberg comes back at him in the VW. Go on, mate, you can do this. I'm enjoying this. That VW with the hard compound of tyre is going to feel awful compared to the Mercedes, but still, he's hanging in there, and this is all to the credit of Toyota in front.
Fair play to Roberto Sternberg, then managing to defend that position, but here comes Baptiste Beauvoir late on the brakes, up the inside he goes, and through into third place, get the cars on this side. Baptiste, no! Contact between the two, just about manages to keep it facing in the straight line. Does Roberto Sternberg, no harm done there, but now they've got a bit of a mountain to climb. There's a second between Toyota and Mercedes, and there's less than two laps remaining.
Yeah, really an awesome couple of laps there from Sternberg, but unfortunately just couldn't quite keep him there. But for Porsche at the head of the field, just a couple more corners separates them between the penultimate lap. I don't think Toyota have enough time to do this. Mercedes don't have enough time to do it. As long as they can just cruise to the end now, keep it going, it should be fine. Meanwhile, Lexus and McLaren are locked in a fight as well. Lexus with a poor start earlier on. McLaren three places up from their grid slot. These guys started, of course, in last place. And still within a chance of taking one more here if they can get Lexus coming onto the final lap.
Yeah, points do mean prizes in this race, and they'll want to get as many as they possibly can. Of course, double points on offer for this grand final. We sit on the final lap. It's Team Porsche with the advantage at the front of this race, but in the battle for eighth, it is coming down to the last run here at the Deep Forest Raceway. Slipstream, of course, here for McLaren as they come across the timing line. Lexus know that. They go for the defensive line in towards the right-hander. We've seen contact here before. Let's see if they can go two by two sensibly into the left. We're about to jink it down. There's a bit of door handle bashing between the two. Lexus on the inside then coming into the braking zone. Can they hold firm and hold the line through there? I think they just about can. McLaren have to go the long way round and get it a bit out of shape coming through the mid part of the corner. It's going to be a run down this back straight then here, surely into the hairpin.
Yeah, Team Porsche though out front on their final lap now. It's been a fantastic dominant drive there by the German manufacturer. Only a few more corners separating them from their first win in the Manufacturers' Cup, putting them in a very, very strong position going into the grand final.
Absolutely fantastic from Team Porsche then. Takuma Sasaki behind the wheel here will bring it home for the German manufacturer in their Porsche 911. A great driver, the lights of the flag victory it is for them as they come out of the final corner and across the line to win race one of the Manufacturers' Cup. Well, finals here in Monaco. Brilliant stuff from Team Porsche, and it's Toyota who are best of the rest in second place, and Mercedes completing the podium in third place as well. Volkswagen will finish in fourth ahead of Subaru in fifth, then Genesis over the line in P6 after a scrappy beginning to their race. Then it's Honda, it'll be Lexus, I think, who will just get the better of McLaren despite the pressure that they've been under on that final lap. But what a fantastic first race in the Manufacturers' Cup. A great start to the evening for Porsche.
Yeah, Porsche, of course, the big winners here in race one. But the big losers, in my eyes, are Genesis. They really threw that one. P6 for them, not going to put them in good stead there for the last race. But it is double points in the grand final, so it is far from over.
You can see the teams and the drivers just discussing with one another there. They're a Team Porsche celebrating with one another. Great drive it was from all three of them. They kept it calm. Angel Estrosa, Jose Serrano, Takuma Sasaki. Here are the highlights then of that race. Porsche led the way into the first corner. There wasn't long before the incident started unfolding. We saw a big moment there. Lexus getting turned round by BMW. We saw Genesis getting a big old bit from Mercedes as well. Mercedes being handed a penalty in the early stages of that one after Lucas Benelli got a bit too greedy into the corner, and visible frustration there for Genesis.
Yeah, but it didn't get much better. Here was the result of the contact between BMW and Lexus, spinning them around.
Well, we're hoping for some team radio there, but I think sound of silence was the order of the day for Genesis. After the first pit stops played out, there was a divergence in strategies with Porsche going onto the soft tyre, Toyota onto the hard, and we wondered how this would work out here for these different drivers, as it all got quite interesting in sort of the mid part of the top 10.
Yeah, it was a great call by Porsche to do that, but Toyota on the slower compound tyre got caught up in some fights, slowed them down on the middle stint there, and ended up getting bullied by Team Subaru mid-sector, so he just punted off to the right there, goodbye, off you go. That was Dream 1 on Fraga. Subaru were giving a 1 second penalty, which did somewhat of halt their charge.
So
Sorry, guys. Sorry.
That's okay. You kept the toe. It's probably faster.
Danny's on a saying it's fine. Do it again.
We saw the McLaren versus
accelerate.
Floor speed.
Floor speed. And that, of course, was the undoing there, and this was the contact that sent Nissan into the shadow realm as they went down the wrong way.
Oh! Oh, no!
No!
Oh, that's a huge pen.
And then we can see Toyota going up the inside of Subaru for third place in the closing stage of this race. Toyota, of course, on the soft carbon of tyre, while Subaru were on the hards and were all at sea. They all got really feisty with just a few laps remaining. Toyota muscling their way through up the inside of Volkswagen and going up into third place. Mercedes fancied a slice of the action as well and got themselves eventually ahead. Ran a little bit onto that corner. There was a bit of contact, but fortunately they both kept it facing the right way and they managed to get the final spot on the podium. After a brilliant end to the race for Baptiste Beauvoir, but what a great drive it was from all three of the Porsche drivers. They came home to take a lights the flag victory. Fantastic result, and you can see visibly the delight for Suzuki there as well. And there we go, they are the results. Team Porsche lead the field, they take 12 points into the grand final ahead of Team Toyota and Mercedes. Then it's Volkswagen, Subaru, Genesis, Honda, Lexus, McLaren, BMW, Nissan, and of course, sadly, a DNF following a technical failure for Team Mazda down in 12th position. But goodness me, what a great way to kick off proceedings there, JB.
Yeah, really enjoyed that one. It was a bit of a slow burn, as we tend to have these manufacturer races, and yeah, strategies come together. But as I say, Team Genesis, they're big losers, getting biffed out of the way, I think, by Mercedes at the start, then having some penalties that are on for some unsafe rejoins. I think that that car seems to be quick, but sixth place definitely isn't where it belongs.
Absolutely. Well, let's head down to Julia then, who is with our Race 1 winners from Team Porsche.
Well, yes, what a fight that was. How are you feeling after that?
I mean, absolutely wonderful, you know. to be honest, at the start, watching Jose, I was suffering a little bit watching Toyota behind us because, you know, the Toyota car has a lot of top speed. So, yeah, anyway, yeah. We all made an awesome job and, well, I have to say that Sasaki-san, he's 18 years old and he's doing such a great job. This guy here as well, so I don't know. It's an awesome team.
How worried were you about your strategy, like especially in that kind of final lap as like Toyota were coming up behind? Were you worried?
Bueno, estás preocupado por la estrategia con Toyota viniendo desde atrás, José?
Pues no, porque sabía que se iban a meter en tráfico y nosotros íbamos a ir solos porque teníamos un muy buen ritmo y la verdad que no ha salido muy bien.
No, absolutely, I was not worried because I knew that Toyota was getting into traffic and we were in our own race without traffic, so yeah, in the end everything worked well for us.
So tell me, what was it like working with these guys?
彼らと一緒に走って、どんな感じですか？どういう感想をお願いします。
そうですね、非常に心強くて、すごくマージンを取っていただいたので、僕は自分の走りに集中することができました。
Yeah, I mean, they're very strong drivers, and because they built such a big gap, you know, before I got in the car, I could really focus on my driving.
So, okay, what's the plan for the grand final?
To fight with everything we have. We know that it is a Spa, the Porsche may be not be that good, but maybe there's some rain coming, hopefully.
So. Maybe.
So yeah.
And it's double points, you know, so.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely, we'll do everything we can.
Why don't we give them a massive round of applause for a very well-run race there. Well done, guys. And we're going to chuck it back to you, Tom and Jimmy.
Yeah, thank you very much, Jules. Very sinister whisper coming from Julia in the middle of that interview. But a huge congratulations to Team Porsche nonetheless. Let's have a look, shall we, at the point standings after that first race in the Manufacturers' Cup World Final. So, of course, we've got the World Series points. We've now got the Race 1 points, and it's advantage Team Toyota by 4 to the good from Subaru.
Yeah, you can see that second place really helped them out there, of course. 4 points now over Subaru. As you said, Mercedes coming into play as well with 15 points, and Porsche, after an awesome Race 1, move up from 0 points back of the pack up to P4. So grand final though, of course, were up double points, so a good result for I think any of the top four or five teams. Could see them rocket up at the top of the top of the table there.
And you can see that DNF really hurt Team Mazda. No points on the board, five points they've accrued over the course of this year, but they're down now in seventh in the standings following everybody else scoring.
I have to pay respects to Mazda. It's not over though, definitely not over.
No, absolutely. Well, let's head over to Julia in a few moments' time. She's going to be with Subaru before we get this grand final race underway.
Having a bit of a chat. Sorry, we're supposed to be doing a live show, I guess. I don't know. Guys, how are you doing? I mean, how was that last race for you?
It's a good race for us because P5 is the maximum for the car. It's not very great so deep for us, but on Spa will be more good for us. Yeah. So yeah, for win the championships, I want this winter's race. So I want. Yeah.
I think it's great seeing you guys together. This is super cool for me. I'm enjoying this immensely. How do you feel going into the race? Like, what's going to be, how are you going to kind of focus and pull it through?
この2人が並んで走ってるのを見るのと、見るのすごく私嬉しくなるんですけど、次のレース、どうやって何に集中して勝とうと思っていますか？
はい。まあ、僕もキリアンとダニエルと一緒にチームを組めるのは非常に、今回すごい嬉しいですし、決勝はもうなるようになると思うので、個人的には雨が降るのをすごい期待しているので、雨が降ってくれればいいなと思ってて、でまあ、3人で力を合わせて、チャンピオンを取れたらなというふうに思っています。
Yeah, so I mean, I'm very happy to be here, you know, driving together with Killian Daniel, and you know,In the final, I hear that there may be some rain. We're pretty good in the rain. I'm pretty good in the rain, so I'm hoping that it does come. And I just want to work together with them to you know, try to win.
And so as it's kind of a little bit up in the air, you know, what the weather might be, maybe in the last one, how have you practiced for this?
Yeah, I practice a lot on the rain. Yes. Yeah, because it's really important for the race. So I hope you have some months rain for the race, so I hope.
It's not often, I think, that a driver's like, yeah, you know what, let's have some rain. Doesn't happen that often. Well, look, you guys are amazing drivers. We have every confidence in you, and I think good luck going into that grand final. Thank you. Thanks. Back to you, Tom and Jimmy.
Yeah, thank you very much indeed, Jules. So let's have a look, shall we, at the points going into the grand final. Of course, it is double points for this last race. So it's still all to play for, despite the gap of 4 points at the top of the tables.
Yeah, we have seen in the past in the Manufacturers' Cup that some teams may be completely out of it already. Just go ahead and smash the grand final, get that full 24 points, and then just rocket up the sheets up into the pole position there. But here is the circuit. You might recognize this one. It's Circuit de Spa Francorchamps, said in my best French accent. Was that all right? Was that good?
Given it's a Belgian circuit.
Yeah, but isn't French style accent?
I don't know. You could speak Flemish if you wanted to. Anyway, grid order is made by the race one results. 30 laps for this one. It's going to be a long old race. This. We're reckoning about 70 minutes or so there and thereabouts. So that's going to be pretty exciting.
Can we get a seat up here, boys? All right, but yeah, racing hard, intermediate, and heavy wet tyres. And as we sort of heard down there, we reckon there might be a little bit of rain at some point. We don't know when, but definitely something for our drivers to contend with. Because driving in the dry is one thing, you do that easy, you always go for the best conditions. But in the wet, it all gets sort of turned upside down.
Well, I hark back to when we had one of the World Series events in the rain earlier on here this year. Do you remember, was it Takuma Miyazono, I think it could have been, who managed to just blitz the strategy effectively.
Yeah,
just drove through the field at the end of the race. And I mean, if teams can pull that off and read the weather, read the conditions right, that could be the difference between them finishing, say, sixth or finishing in first.
Exactly. All about being on the right car at the right time. So here, a couple of little stats for you. This is the Manufacturers' Cup in numbers. So Baptiste Beauvoir, he's done the most races yet. 18 races, is that many? Baptiste, mate. Been around for a while, but of course, Igor Fraga and Yamanaka there. 13 top five finishes with Igor Fraga with 7 wins. There's a reason why we talk about Igor Fraga so much. Guy's based.
So eloquently put. Well, this is an endurance race, Jimmy. We love an endurance race. What makes this so special for the strategy?
I think for me, I mean, I'm a massive endurance racing fan. It's you don't necessarily have to be the fastest driver to win. It's just about who has the best head on their shoulders. Who's best at maybe being consistent? Who's best at looking after tyres or reading the track, reading the weather? I think that's the sort of thing that I can get behind because I'm a slow driver. So I like to try and use anything else to my at my disposal there.
And like you say, right tyre at the right time. Do you think some of the teams may take it a bit conservatively given that there are double points on offer, or do you think they're just going to go hell for leather and say, it's solid, it's the grand final?
Depends where you are on the standing. If you're a bit further down, you know, just send it. You know, I'd go for the risky option every time because there's no point being conservative because you won't move up at all. But it also plays into the strategy for which driver is going to be in the car on which tyre. Maybe some drivers here, you say, Mir's only good in the wet. I've heard Fraga's pretty decent in the wet as well. Getting him out there on that tyre at that moment is going to be really important. Of course, we've also said, every time you come into the pit lane and change tyres, you have to change drivers. So if we have more than two stops, they have to go back to the first driver once again. So it can get... It's quite hard to understand it all.
Yeah, we need a pen and a paper and a very, very big pad, I think, to be honest with you. Anyway, of course, we have got some big, exciting news to unveil here tomorrow for the Nations Cup World Finals. We're live at 5 p.m. here in Monaco, and you can see the Ferrari Vision Gran Turismo is going to be unveiled. And genuinely, no word of a lie, we haven't seen this car yet. So the first time we see it will be with you guys live on the stream. So let's get ready then, shall we, to go for the Manufacturers Cup. It is time for the grand finals here in Monaco. We're about to crown our world champions. Let's see who is going to reign supreme. We began the season a very long time ago, and it all comes down to now. 30 laps of Spa-Francorchamps will decide our Manufacturers' Cup World Champions for 2022. And here is how the grid will be formed for the last race of the season. Team Porsche will start from pole position alongside them, Team Toyota. The next row of the grid is comprised of Mercedes-AMG. Next up, it is Team Volkswagen, a strong end to their race despite being on the hard tyres in race one. Team Subaru head the third row of the grid with Genesis, the newcomers in 2022, lining up P6. Then it is Honda in P7 alongside Lexus in P8 on the grid. Ninth position is McLaren with a scrappy first race. They'll be hoping for cleaner things in race two, the grand final. BMW line up alongside them. Team Nissan down on the final row of the grid in 11th place. And great to see Mazda back out and ready to go here for the grand final. And of course, Jimmy, one thing we have to mention, there's a bit of rain on the horizon and it's already raining now.
It is raining. And interestingly, Team Toyota, the only team to go for that full wet tyre. Everyone else an intermediate. So this could either be a masterstroke from Team Toyota or a disaster. But regardless, on that intermediate compound tyre, taking that line, that racing line is going to be very tricky. The traditional racing line is already rubbered up. It's going to be slippy. So you have to try and weigh up whether it's going to take the wet line or stay on that dry racing line for the quickest line through the corner. But 20 laps coming up here at Spa. Team Porsche leading the way. This is going to be a super interesting race.
Just saw Adam Christodoulou, factory Mercedes AMG driver, down there talking to the AMG team. Maybe he can impart some words of wisdom. There's Igor Fraga also communicating with his team as we get ready to go then. So we're about to crown our world champions. It is time for the Manufacturers' Cup Grand Finals here in Monaco as we go green and go racing for the final time in 2022 as Porsche lead the field across the timing line and down in towards the first corner of La Source. So it's Porsche from Toyota, from Mercedes into the first corner. Of course, that rolling start spreads the field out. Don't expect too many moves to be made in the early stages, although Honda seems to be making an ascension through the field. Let's see how the full wet tyres are going to work out for Toyota as we come up the rise through Eau Rouge and Radion for the first time.
Already a second from Porsche to Toyota, so Toyota really struggling to get out of the source, getting on the hairpin there on that heavy, wet compound, a tire, and immediately you can see darting offline, trying to one, break the toe, and two, keep that tire cool. But in the slipstream there, in the draft, putting up Genesis there alongside Honda as we go into Lake Home for the first time. Honda is defending for now, so keeping the place at the moment. But Honda up two places there from the starting position. Subaru on that main straight there, down two, just not able to keep the rest of the pack with the straight line speed.
Yeah, Nico Romero doing a good job behind the wheel of that Genesis to get his elbows out in the early stages whilst the field is really bunched up down in towards Rivage we go. This is turn eight. The car always wants to understeer going through here. And you can see, of course, that the front engine cars are going to be a little bit harder to turn than some of the mid-engine machines as we go through the left-hander of Ixon on the run down the hill in towards Puon. So a 9/10 of a second is the advantage here for Team Porsche. And I wonder whether it's going to be a case of the cork in the bottle for Mercedes and Volkswagen once they're able to depose of Toyota on those intermediate tyres, whether they will be able to pull out an advantage. Of course, there's a big variable here because if the rain gets harder, then Toyota will be in the pouncing, but they need to not burn those tyres up too early on.
What rain? I don't think it's raining. I think it's already stopped raining, Tom, at this point. I can't see any more rain on the windscreen there, so being on that drying line is going to be very, very important. That's a disaster for Toyota if the rain's already stopped. The rest of the field are on the intermediates, and that Toyota's going to be in a heavy wet tyre, which is going to wear extremely quickly on the dry surface. So they're going to have to hope that the circuit stays somewhat wet. And you can see in front there, they're already struggling. 1.5 seconds is a gap between Porsche and Toyota. We saw Igor Fraga at the start of the race, sort of nervously talking to his teammates, saying, you know, I don't know if this was the right choice or not.
Well, we were talking to Team Subaru, who are down in seventh place. Of course, very big title contenders going into this race. We heard from them a few moments ago. We know that car can be pretty handy in wet conditions, but if it does dry out, they may be a bit of a sitting duck. Let's see whether we get any moves being made in towards the bus stop chicane. Toyota on the defensive line there. Mercedes trying to challenge as they come in towards the chicane. We go, lots of moves being made a bit further back there. Looks like BMW are coming under a bit of pressure from Nissan. Nobody able to make anything meaningful coming into that corner, though. It's Volkswagen getting a warning for colliding with another car. They're sitting P4, so let's see. Whoa, look at that. Late on the brakes, as you like, in towards Lassource we go. For Mercedes, just going to show how much more grip there is on that intermediate tyre compared to the full wet.
And even despite going wide there, Mercedes still had a better exit in terms of speed coming out of the corner. They're a bit slow there mid-corner, but their actual launch of the corner was quicker than Toyota. And now they're in that draft. The only thing saving at Toyota right now is its straight line speed. The rain has started a little bit, going to see it on circuit there, though. So it isn't all doom and gloom for Toyota, but... yeah, at the moment, Porsche being treated to a race lead. Last lap was a second and a bit quicker than Team Toyota. Everyone seems to be stuck behind them at the moment.
Takuma Sasaki finished the race for Porsche in race one. He starts the race for Porsche here in race two and doing a good job, as you say, of just building up that gap. 1.5 seconds, it now sits at me right on board here with Volkswagen, with Suzuki, who is behind the wheel. Just in front of him is the Mercedes of Lucas Benelli. We know he was in the wars during his first stint last time out in that first race. Into Rivage we go, and this is going to be really interesting to see how it works out. So it's all about smooth input in the wet here for these drivers. You don't want to be spinning up the wheels too much. You want to be trying to avoid things like the curbs and the white lines, just so you can get as optimal traction as you possibly can.
You say that, these guys are all over them, so they're still managing to make it work somehow. See VW there, right on the curb on the way into the corner, watching Mercedes AMG. They need to get by Toyota as quick as possible, really. There are the points, by the way, if the race ended as of now. So Toyota can come second and still win this, but Porsche need to win and really have Toyota fall back a little bit more in the standings. But there is Porsche, that gap now up to 2 seconds. Toyota and Mercedes, they're glued together. And we need to see Lucas Benelli make that move on Igor Fraga. He needs to make it soon.
Absolutely, I think that the best opportunity will come into the bus stop chicane if he can get a good run out of Paul Freire here and then through Blanchimont. The good advantage for him is, of course, he has got that bit of slipstream being created, that bit of the hole in the air being pushed in front of him. Let's ride on board with the Mercedes and see what Toyota will do, if they'll opt for that defensive line coming into the chicane or just decide to let them go. I don't think they're going to give up that position too easily as they come through the left-hander of Blanchimont into the chicane. They're a bit too far away, but Lucas Benelli, we know he's not afraid of a lunge. You can see the Toyota being parked in the middle of the corner. Igor Fraga doing a good job of just holding that car, holding that position as best as he can. This is a nothing else, a really good demonstration of how to defend properly from Igor Fraga.
Yeah, really nice positioning there for Igor, just walking Benelli out to the outside of the circuit, giving him no room to perhaps try and move. Same again down at the source here, but Benelli's going to try the switch back here in the Mercedes. He'll have better traction as well coming out of the corner, but isn't quite close. The fact Toyota's got some legs on it. It can just pull away from pretty much any car in a straight line. Despite that, though, Benelli is now right up in the sixth. And meanwhile, three wide behind for 8th, 9th and 10th place. Lexus, Mazda and McLaren heading that little pack there. These guys are fighting hard in the midfield. I think trying maybe just to get out of this pack and move up Nissan there as well.
Four drivers then, four manufacturers all squabbling for position. Let's see what happens as we come up the ride through the Kemmel straight then. So here Mazda jinking to the inside of Lexus. Nissan with a lot of momentum, but no room to be able to use it. They're kind of boxed in as they come in towards Lake Coombe. On the outside, they run into the right-hander.
It looks like in the front of the field, sorry to cut you off there, Tom, but Mercedes have taken now Toyota. Toyota have fallen back into third position. Igor Fraga unable to keep Benelli behind in the Mercedes. Now he'll go off into pursuit of Team Porter. The gap is 1.7 seconds, so not as big as it was before. So I wonder, oh, contact in the background. Lexus there hits Mazda. Mazda goes right. It's been a disastrous weekend for Mazda off the circuit. Now, I'm not sure if Lexus were pushed themselves there. We're going to get a replay of this is Mercedes on Toyota.
Yeah, so down the Kemmel straight they go in towards Lake Coombe. It's going to be a nice move on the inside for the brakes here for Lucas Benelli. He goes on the inside of Igor Fraga, gets that one done, pushes Fraga towards the outside. Bit of hip and shoulder through there, but all's fair in love and war, and he's now up into second place. Now the question is, how quickly are they going to be able to gap already after just half a lap? It's up to nearly 8/10 of a second. I wonder whether Toyota might end up being the cork in the bottle. Incident, no surprise there, under investigation. Meanwhile, between Mazda and Nissan and Lexus for the moment we saw in turn 8. We'll be keen to see what the stewards award for that. I'd love to see another angle of it, because we only really caught the back end of that incident, but either way, it is ruined what has been, as you said, Jimmy, a dog's day at the office for Mazda. No points in race one, right at the back now by some 6.5 seconds here in race two as well.
Yeah, just notice it is still raining at Spa at the moment, so the rain is still coming down, which is some respite for Toyota, at least on that heavy, wet compound tyre. I would say, though, the intermediate is the tyre to be on at the moment. Just a bit more braking performance available, a bit more cornering performance available on that tyre than on the wet tyre, but Fraga should be able to keep that tyre alive. We'll just have to suffer with the pace deficit for a little bit longer, but look behind him, massive train of cars there behind Toyota. So can they hold off the pack behind?
Second lap or not, I think we will be faster, I think.
Oh, Toyota just went wet.
Yeah, that might just cost him a world championship, Nico.
Probably.
Interesting there. Interesting. Hearing Genesis talking about Toyota saying being on the wet tyre might have just cost them the championship.
It's a very good point, because of course they are only 4 points ahead when they were in second place. If the checkered flag fell when they were in second, they would have got the championship. Let's have another look at a replay of this incident then. So we're on board here with Nissan in 11th place. Mazda just up the road, Lexus just ahead of them. So Mazda go to the inside, there's contact. Oh, it's just way too late on the brakes, and then Nissan drive join in sympathy as well. Let's have some team radio.
Oh, come on, come on.
Oh, man.
Who was that?
You know, I'd say as well, like, that was a very, very late move to the right by Lexus to defend. I mean, Mazda was already going up the inside when they moved, so stewards are a lovely in-house stewards. We'll look at that. I'm going to be very nice to them now.
I was going to say, ever since you called them mean on Thursday, you've been on the chart. Yeah, take them out for dinner next.
Yeah, I mean, whatever stops them from keying my car. Yeah. Whatever stops them from that. But we're on board now with Team Honda, who have made their way past VW and now are in pursuit of Mercedes in front. Matt McEwen there putting in a fantastic drive in the Honda in these difficult conditions. But we're seeing that Mercedes has fallen 2.2 seconds behind Porsche. Toyota 1.7 seconds behind Mercedes. And now Matt McEwen is starting to reel that Toyota in. It's a completely different line there on the way into the corner from Team Toyota in front. A lot shallower on the apex, a bit more grip there at this point in the race. I'm trying to stay off that curve a little bit more. And as you can see, if the live points, if it ended this way, it would be tied on the points. And because Porsche would win this race, Porsche would actually be the ones that take the overall championship there. The grand final result is a decider if the points are tied.
Exactly. And there you can see the live point standing, or the points tally if as the race will be, because it's double points, of course, for this grand final. Look at this train of cars coming in towards Blanchimont. Let's have another look then between Volkswagen and Honda as they come down the back straight, up the rise, I should say, on the Camel Straight in towards Lake Oven, already before they've got into the braking zone. They're ahead, so that's just a good example of how you can use that momentum on the right through Rouge and Radion. Look here at Subaru versus Honda then. Honda really now in the wars. It's all going to concertina up through the bus stop chicane as they come out of it now and over the timing line. They're all getting really scrappy in the opening stages here, and the rain is coming down. You can see that visibly on your screen. It's not getting too heavy. Look at that, all of this as they come in towards the first corner. Subaru run themselves out a little bit too deep. That's going to allow Volkswagen to pull alongside on the run down into Eau Rouge and Radion. Side by side they come in. Bottlenecks up here, and they have to jig back behind for a moment, or do they? It's very difficult to tell, but Volkswagen now are ahead of Subaru. So Volkswagen up into P5. Their next target is Honda. Can they get ahead of the German Japanese manufacturer?
Yeah, Subaru just doesn't have the horsepower. It can't defend on this straight. It needs to be ahead and in clean air, really, to make the most of its speed. So being behind VW here is sort of disastrous. They need to be in clean air in the middle sector, really pushing the car to its limits there, and then just damage limitation on the rest of the lap. As you can see, the tyres available for this race, racing hard the intermediate compound, which the majority of the field are on now, and the full wet tyre, which Igor Fraga is on the Toyota. To his credit, doing a decent job still hanging in there in third place, but the rest of the field definitely quicker than him at this point. They just need to get there.
So, on board we ride here with Danny Solis behind the wheel of that Subaru. We know that car's got incredible grip in the corners, but that lack of straight line speed has really been punishing them so far. Let's see whether Danny is going to be able to try and upset the order as they come through Puon and then in towards the pit path into that chicane which follows. You can see really good mid-corner exit. Lexus, illegal blocking, 1 second penalty. That'll be for the move we saw earlier on. And you can see diving down the inside is Danny Solis on the Volkswagen then. So they get ahead of Suzuki. And look at McLaren ready to try and join in here as well. On the outside, they're going to run those, going to be onto the curb. I think they're going to be a bit compromised, but they still have the inside line and the momentum into the right hand. And Lexus are about to serve their penalty. Up the inside they go. Volkswagen pushed out, losing out also here to Lexus and possibly here to Nissan too, as we come through Paul Freya then and in towards the run to the bus stop chicane. So here's the penalty being served for Lexus. That drops them out of contention and right back into 10th position as it stands for now. But McLaren really deciding to make hay whilst the sun shines. Constantinou, the Greek driver, getting his elbows out here.
Yeah, watch him into the bus stop here. That McLaren's got a bit more straight line speed than the Subaru. Not quite close enough for a move, or is he? Almost runs into the back of the Subaru there, coming into the first braking zone. The VW and Nissan go side by side. The Nissan there just doesn't roll a bit too early, a bit of oversteer, really compromises his entry into the left-hander there. That would have slowed him up on the straight back down the ninth place goes there, but it's a good opportunistic move there by Danny Solis on the other end of the lap, but now he's got to try and defend from McLaren. You watch out of the corner here, as that Subaru out of the corner, it's better on the initial exit, but now look as the Subaru and its lack of power just falls back into the clutches of McLaren. Can Constantino say get by before he doesn't know? He decides to lift out of it. He's going to try and get a bit of a slingshot now and then run through here and then try. Again, Honda very slow there, coming through Rouge Radion. What happened to Honda?
I think they must have had a bit of a moment there. Matt McEwen coming through there, and if there's one moment you don't want to have, it's going through Rouge Radion. Here we go then, as we come in towards the Lake Coombe corner, and it's Subaru up the inside of Honda, going through and into fourth place. So that just shows one simple mistake when you're running in a pack of cars like this can really cost you dear, and possibly Honda set to lose out here as well to McLaren, because Matt McEwen's really got the bit between his teeth. You can see the line point standings on the right-hand side of your screen, and look at that, three manufacturers separated by just 1 point. It would be Toyota who, according to what that graphic says, would finish at the top of it. But of course, we know that it would be Porsche who would be crowned the manufacturers Cup champions of 2022, because it goes off of the grand final result. Look at BMW meanwhile up the inside of Lexus. Lexus trying to find their way back through after a penalty earlier on, but BMW now ahead and up a position. So Kodaka, the Japanese driver, goes through into P10. His next target will be the Nissan of Matteo Estevez.
Yeah, really really tight at the top now, and that was essential for Subaru to get by, because now they can just go through that middle sector, do what they want to do, and then try and use the cornering ability of that Subaru BRZ. Now already 6 tenths behind Toyota, so Subaru moving up in this mid-centre of the race here, and we start maybe Honda having some, I'll say, tyre wear issues. I'm looking at their tyres. completely fine from what I've been seeing on our tyre wear here at the moment. But Matt McEwen just having a few bad corners there, and now falling back down into the clutches of the McLaren behind. You can see Valerio Galdea's teammate on the team radio maybe offering some words of advice there to the Kiwi driver at the moment as we come through the left-hander. Looking at that now from McLaren, is it going to be a move here? McLaren looks to the outside, he's going to try the long way around at the bus stop. All the Honda has to do really square at the corner, just run them out wide, but no, gives them the space. And McLaren, awesome move there, round the outside. Through goes McLaren up into fifth place, and now in pursuit of the Subaru in front.
Lovely stuff behind as well. Genesis and Volkswagen were knocking seven bells at one another. They were going side by side into Blanchimont. Genesis prevailing as it stands for now, but Volkswagen very much in the wars after starting quite far up the order.
You're bouncing the difference now between the fastest car in the straight line and the slowest. Look at that, Toyota just pulls away from us like we're standing still down the straight. We'll be getting a little bit of the draft as we're on board here with Daniel Solis once again. The gap up to half a second from about two temps coming through the source. And now look behind us as well, McLaren. Look how quick that car is in a straight line. That poor little Subaru having to fend for itself through there. But Igor was a little bit slow through Rouge and Brando. I had to slow the car down a bit. Those wet tyres now have been starting perhaps to go the other way. There's a big lunge there from Daniel. What a move there. Very, very confident. Is he going to be able to complete it, though? He is. There you go. What a move from Daniel Solis. That's the height of confidence there. Whether he meant to go from that far back, though, I'm not sure.
Do you think that was the Koke Lopez strategy where he just made a complete mess of the braking? So look at where we are, side by side. Honda versus McLaren into Rivage. McLaren shuffled out wide. Is that going to cost them more than one place? It is, because Genesis goes siding on through as well into sixth position. So McLaren and Matt McEwen going backwards here on this lap, and that goes back to what I was saying earlier on. When you're running in a group like that, just getting shuffled out wide, it's like touring car racing, this, because it can really cost you very dear. Look at that lunge down the inside into Puan then for Genesis, up through into fifth place. What a great bit of driving there from Nico Romero. He's really got the bit between his teeth, and McLaren behind aren't done here either.
He said touring car driving there. I mean, he went straight for it, really on the court there, just straight through up into fifth place. VW there getting by McLaren in the background as well. So a poor few corners there for McLaren, puts him down into a place. We change just how tight this midfield battle is. One moment of mistake, one bit of hesitation, and you find yourself losing a couple of places. So, as the order stands now, as we come to the end of lap 7, it's Porsche, Mercedes, Subaru, Toyota, Genesis, who we're on board with now, and Honda, Volkswagen, McLaren, and Nissan in this group, just behind BMW, Lexus, and Mazda, of course, after their first incident. Here are the 5-point standings. If the race finished now, Porsche will be champions from Mercedes-AMG from Toyota, but only 3 points in it at the top, with Subaru just in fourth. But Genesis now looking round the outside of Igor Fraga and Toyota. So they go the long way around, and Fraga there, I think, coming into the pits, he's had enough of his tyres.
Yeah, I think you're completely right, and he needs to as well, because those wet tyres are not doing them any favours at all. We know that Toyota's going to be quick.
Onto the hard compound they go.
So they're going to be the first to blink. We see the wet dry line beginning to appear. The rain has eased in intensity. And the thing is, though, that dry line, though it is appearing, it's incredibly narrow. So that's from Team Radio.
How is the weather radar?
It's going to get dry, for sure. Please stand by. I think I will do another lap and I will pit for the hard.
So, an early call there for Team Toyota onto the hard tyres. Could that be inspired for the Mazda also following the same strategy? I mean, to be fair, Mazda are at the other end of the scale. They've got nothing to lose, really, at this point.
We're about to see Ferrero Rouge and Radiant for the first time. How's that car look? Big lift through there. You saw coming out of the pit lane there, the car wiggling, trying to put the power down on that slick compounder tyre. This slick compounder tyre, when it hits water, you just ride on top of the water, you aquaplane. So, staying on that lighter line that you can see on the racetrack, or the darker line, sorry, that is the dry line. You want to stay there, that's where the grip is. Now that the rain has stopped, that dry line is going to get wider and wider, and the hard tyre is probably going to be the tyre to be on. I would give it maybe one more lap before coming in for that hard compound of tyre, but we'll see. The other teams now will be keeping an eye on the sector time of Toyota on Mazda, saying, right, are they quick? It's Nikita Moisov now in the car for Team Toyota. We know this guy is quick in the Supra, so we'll have to see what he can do. I mean, it could be an amazing decision. It could be their undoing.
Well, let's see at the sector times as it plays out. You can see Mazda there just in the background, but Nikita Moisov behind the wheel. It's all about paint codes in this weather, where the matte paint is effectively the drier part of the circuit, the darker part of the circuit, which Jim was talking about. That's where the grip is. If it's on the shiny part, the gloss paint, if you like, that's where there is no grip. And you'll see the drivers trying to go to the wetter part of the track, who are on the intermediate tyres, trying to keep them as cool as they possibly can. Let's see where the Porsche are going to retaliate and blink for their first driver change. Currently behind the wheel of that Porsche is Takuma Sasaki. Into the braking zone of the bus stop we go, and are they going to come into the pit stop for theirs? No, they're not. They're going to continue on for another lap.
Mistake. Toyota's middle sector was one of the fastest middle sector from what I can see from anyone, so they should have all be coming in now for that hard compound tyre. Going round another lap for the intermediates, I think, is probably the wrong idea. Genesis coming in for the hard tyre, as are McLaren at this point. Interestingly, Porsche, Mercedes and Subaru opting to try and play it safe, but I think Toyota here have played the best hand. They're going to be quick now this first couple of laps. The tyres are going to be up at temperature as well. That's important. Getting your tyres up at temperature in these conditions is pretty much half of the battle. So they've done that already. Now they'll be charging. I'll keep a very close eye on their sectors.
Nico Romero out. Yuito Sasaki in for Genesis. We ride on board with the Japanese driver coming out of the pit lane there. Then look at this train of cars emerging out of Lasseur's as they come through. You can see Mazda there just in the background there, of course, on the hard tyres. The hard tyres up to temperature, though, for them, because they've already had a lap on them. And look at that dry line getting drier and drier, corner by corner, sector by sector. And as you said, Jimmy, the top three playing it safe, going on to the staying on the intermediate tyres, not wanting to risk that too soon. But the track looking really very much like it is suitable for dry tyres. We know that because, of course, the sector times have been strong for Toyota. The thing is, for Toyota, they're in traffic, but not for long, because here they go, up the inside of Genesis and through into fourth place. Nice bit of clear air for them. That was crucial for their strategy.
Nice decisive move there. Yeah, they're having those turns up and champ really, really paying dividends there. For
McLaren
in the background there. I have no idea what happened. I think maybe got on the gas a bit too early. Massive, massive moment. And off into the gravel go McLaren from what was a very strong position there. I think just caught out there, Tom, by the wet part of the circuit. If you get onto that wet part of the circuit, the darker part of the circuit, as you can see on your screen there, you become a passenger. I think McLaren just clipped that out of the way and round they went. That's the end of them.
Hayato Imazato, who was driving the car at the time, the Japanese driver. Let's see if we can piece together exactly what happened. So we're coming through Lei Koum into the right-hander. He's on the wet part of the circuit. Just no grip out there. He just aquaplaned off. That's what we're talking about. You've got to keep it to the... Oh, and the thing is as well, he came back onto the track, and I think got a bit of contact from some of the other cars. But that's what we were saying. When you've got that dry line and it's so narrow, if you go onto the wet part, there's no grip, and you're going to go straight to the scene of the accident.
Fortunate for them. Now, I suspect we're going to see Porsche, Mercedes and Subaru getting into the car now. I can see one of the Mercedes drivers just waiting there to get into the car for Benelli. It's going by Porsche into the pit lane. Our leaders comes into the pit lane to go onto what I assume will be the hard compound of tyres. Mercedes, I think, are going to probably follow them in the background. They do. Subaru there as well, ready to change tyres. So now our entire field going onto that hard compound of tyre. Let's see if it was the right choice.
So we're a third of the way through this grand final for the Manufacturers' Cup, and now we see exactly what it is going to mean for Team Porsche to have waited another lap to come onto that harder compound of tyre. Mercedes and Subaru also following suit, of course, but now as we emerge from the pit lane with Porsche, they will of course hold on to the race lead. We know that much, but they've got to get those tyres up to working temperature. That dry line getting wider and wider and more grip onto the circuit. Mazda and Volkswagen under investigation for colliding with another car, and Helena Stroza, I mean, if there's a man you want in the car to try and push and extract the maximum from it, it's got to be the Chilean.
Angel has been part of the Porsche manufacturing team for a very, very long time. As you say, Tom, he knows his car back to front. He's got that hard compound of tyre on, now the slick tyre. He will be just head down, blinkers on, trying to extract as much speed as possible from that Porsche. Oh my word, Mazda kicking it with the 1080, still going round into the gravel they go. And that's what happens when you touch the wet part of a circuit. You become a passenger, as did the VW, and unsurprisingly, Mazda, of course, they didn't intend to do it. 2 second penalty.
Genesis under pressure here from Subaru. Let's not have a repeat of what we saw last time around. Will they go for the inside line to revise? Well, I think they probably thought better of that, and thankfully they decide not to go for a move, because we know it's incredibly slippery, as we just saw into the braking zone. It's Andrew Brooks who is behind the wheel of the Mazda. Behind the wheel of the Genesis is Yuito Sasaki. Behind the wheel of the Subaru is the 2020 Nations Cup champion, and of course the manufacturer's champion as well, of Takuma Miyazono. Subaru won it back in 2020. 2020. They'd love to be able to reclaim the crown in 2022, but it's going to be a tall order, as you can see there. Slight moment for Toyota. Subaru emerging from the pits. Let's see what happens here as they come down into Eau Rouge and Radion. And look at this, decisive driving here from the Nikita Moisov. Gets it done and passed onto the wet part of the track. Nicely done there for them.
That would have been scary there, going onto that wet part of the circuit. And now, look, already on the back of Mercedes AMG. So getting those tyres sorted early was crucial for them. And this is crucial for Toyota as well. It moves them back up into a position where they will become the Manufacturers' Cup champions here. But they need to execute this properly. It's very hard to overtake, but there's very much still a dry line and a wet part of the circuit. You don't want to try and dive up the inside on the wet line, because you're just going to go flying off the track, as you saw just a minute ago with Team Mazda. So patience here is what Nikita Moisov needs to employ behind the Mercedes AMG. And oh, a little bit slow in the exit there, just runs into the back. You see, that's what happens. He just got onto that wet part of the track. No traction there, and then just almost got ran into by the AMG behind.
Shinsuke Sobi behind the wheel of the Mercedes, really trying his best at the moment, but Nikita Moisov has got great traction out of Lasource. We know he's not afraid of making a move into Eau Rouge and Radion. He's a bit too far away on this occasion, but if he can set himself up through the top of the circuit on the rise to the Kemmel Straight, this could be the opportunity that they're looking for. Slightly different in lines there. I think Sobi was a little bit wide through there, and that's allowing Moisov to close up as he comes into the slipstream. And on the right of the Kemmel Straight, he's going to park it to the left-hand side of the circuit, and let's see whether this is going to be an easy move. I think it will be for Team Toyota, and Moisov, they go through up into second, and crucially back into the lead of the Manufacturers' Cup. If the checkered flag fell now, it would be Toyota who are crowned as the Manufacturers' Cup champions of 2022.
They did their best there to try and keep them on the wet line, but Toyota's had the straight line speed just so much they can just drive around there. But Genesis in play as well in the background in fourth place there. Porsche having a great race, it has to be said. 6.5 seconds clear, of anyone at the moment. It wouldn't be good enough.
Porsche had a problem. Whoa. They've spun into the left-hand Ravix, and the race leaders look like they've possibly thrown it all away here. Angel Estrosa, who was behind the wheel, we were singing his praises just a couple of laps ago, and whether he got onto the wet part of the circuit, I don't know. But from the race lead down to fourth place here for Team Porsche, that is an absolute disaster for the German manufacturer.
I don't think I've ever had a commentator's curse that strong. Oh my, so what happened? It was here at Ix.
White line.
Oh, just hits the white line and into the wall. We have a little bit of damage from that as well there. So, oh, Angel, it's so easy to do. He was pushing. The track just wasn't quite there yet. It's a real shame for Angel and Estrosa, but all you can do now is get your head back down, try and focus on just getting in those lap times. You can see Benelli there. Things are getting a bit leery. At the moment, Mercedes actually going backwards. What happened to Mercedes? They've fallen 6 seconds behind now. Has there been an issue there for Mercedes?
I wonder whether they may have gotten caught up in that incident there with Porsche, because, of course, all the field came round at a relatively similar sort of time. Genesis now elevating themselves up into second, so whether Mercedes were just innocent victims in the party, I don't quite know. Here you can see McLaren, meanwhile, ready to lose ninth place, quite possibly, here to Volkswagen, who have had a challenging race here so far. Let's see whether they can defend that position into the bus stops again. We go, just holding firm for the time being. Under investigation are Porsche for driving dangerously post-incident, so that could be salt in the wound for Porsche, because Inostroza may be set to pick up a penalty. We saw that, didn't we, in race one, driving dangerously post-incident, and a penalty was awarded.
Yeah, the stewards are very hot now. They don't like you rejoining in the silly way. You can cause other crashes and basically involving someone else in your crash when they are innocent victims. So, Mercedes AMG and Subaru close together on circuit now, because Mercedes losing a bit of time through there. Just not quite got the pace through Eau Rouge and Radion there. The Subaru right up behind, almost pushing the car. In fact, they are a little bit of bump drafting there from the Subaru. It's to keep a Miazona in the car at the moment. You see, it gets that straight line speed differential. This is difficult territory for the Subaru, because we know it's quicker, but it can't pull off lines still to go for the overtake. The dry line is getting wider and wider as the laps go on and the cars remove more of that water. But there's just no way around it for Miazona in that Subaru.
I have to say, the circuit was looking pretty clear overhead. But I have to say, there's a few clouds just beginning to gather. I don't think there's anything too much to concern, but we know the weather radar in Gran Turismo can come in pretty fast. So let's keep an eye on that and just see whether those clouds do begin to come in and have an effect. I don't think there's anything, like I say, to worry about at the moment. We're very much under dry conditions. It's still very much a drying circuit, but just food for thought a little bit later on, perhaps, in this race. So here is Subaru then all over the rear wing of Mercedes-AMG, just coming through Pouillon then into the chicane we go, hard on the brakes into there, and just sitting in the wheel tracks of Mercedes. That's all they can do. If anything, they need to be the ones that are drafted here to Subaru.
You can't see that dry line, how wide it is now. So
let's have
a replay of the incident with Porsche. So see, we just go too wide on the way into X, such a curb, and we're a passenger engine. Nothing they can do about that. What a shame.
Whoa! No te puedo creer. No te puedo creer. No te puedo creer.
Did very well not to swear there, because I know what my vocabulary would have been full of after that.
Yeah.
Just because it normally is, anyway. Look at Subaru then, all over the gearbox here of Mercedes coming in towards the bus stop chicane. Are they going to be able to find their way through? A warning is given to Porsche then, following driving dangerously post-incident. So thankfully, it's not a penalty to just compound their woes, but they do still sit in third place, having got themselves back past Nissan. But they are now 5.6 seconds off the lead at the front. They have gifted this back to Toyota.
What a shame. I was really looking forward to seeing what Porsche could do here. They didn't fall far enough, though, to help out Toyota, sorry, to help out Subaru, to help out Mercedes. So they are still in this fight. And they're only 6 seconds off the lead. We do have still over half the race to go here. It's an endurance race, after all, so it isn't over until it's over. And we've seen the weather change so far. It might change again. Who the hell knows at this point? But right now, the guys are trying to focus on keeping the car on that lighter line there, on the dry line. As soon as you touch the darker line there, which is a wet part of the circuit, that's the tyre loses pretty much all the grip. We saw what happened in Astroza.
Absolutely. You can see the Mercedes team there watching on, Baptiste Beauvoir, who will be in the car at the end of this race for their final stint.
Just flying right now. Look at this. 6 tenths of a second now behind Toyota. I just saw Toyota, and that's Moisov at the wheel there. Have a big moment down at Abrivage there, just trying to gather the car back up again. So Genesis right now with Sasaki at the wheel really is showing what this car can do. And he's gaining back in Toyota hand over fist. I'm not sure where they are at the points at the moment, Genesis. So we'll have to wait till we get our points table flash at the moment. You can see Romero and Hell praying to the Gran Turismo gods for some good luck here. But they don't need it right now because just doing a great job. The car is fast.
The thing is, what the drivers want at this point is they want the race to stay as dry as possible, because they can just continue on this strategy. It won't disrupt their flow too much. As we said, if the weather does come in again and we don't know what is going to happen, there is a possibility that that will change. At the moment, it's in the pound seats here for Genesis, and this is great to see a new manufacturer coming on board for 2022, fighting up the sharp end of the field. Just to give you an idea of the pace difference between them, Toyota last time around 220.2, Genesis at 219.6. They were significantly faster, really, really good pace in these drying conditions.
They actually set the fastest lap of the race on the last lap. So they are, they're rocketing right now. So up in the toe of Team Toyota. We'll have a look at lap times when they come in, but definitely is starting to gain on the Toyota in front. It's more in that middle sector, isn't it? That's where the car is quicker. And again, another fastest lap of the race there for Team Genesis, and 0.4 seconds quicker than the car in front.
The thing is, that's all relative, because it's going to get faster as the circuit gets drier, isn't it, really? But Genesis doing a really good job. I have to say, Toyota did respond a little bit more on that lap last time around, only 0.4 seconds between the two, but still, the gap, it's kind of beginning to stabilise now. So whether Moisov is just beginning to realise, actually, I'm coming under a bit of pressure here and starting to pull the pin again, maybe turning his fuel mixture up to a bit higher of a limit. Look here at Nissan and Porsche, and Nissan are going to try and go past Porsche then. So Angel Astroza has already lost the race lead. He's going to be set to lose third place here. And the Japanese manufacturer with Okamoto behind the wheel goes through and into third place at the top of Lake Oum.
Go on, Nissan. It's been a while since they've been up in the top three. A plus eight on their grid position. So it's a hell of a race from the Nissan boys so far. Turbo Brick is still alive and well. You can't get rid of it. But yeah, that's going to be just disappointment. Big time there for Angel Astroza as Nissan gets slightly there through the right-handed Okamoto at the wheel of that Nissan at the moment. But yeah, I think the wind's out the sails there of Angel Astroza from the Porsche. I think maybe it's just that slide didn't help as well in terms of tyre wear.
Jimmy, just give us an insight of what it's like to drive in these conditions. Of course, we've had intermediate conditions now into a drying circuit. How do you read the circuit like this from a driver's perspective?
Well, right now, this is in your head. You're like, right, dry racing, dry driving pretty much. I mean, you watch out for the curbs, you watch out for the white lines still, but you can see the circuit, and the important part is dry. So you treat the car like it's a dry circuit. You push it into the corners hard, you keep the tyres warm as you go around, but you also have to have that little bit of caution when overtaking or when being overtaken. Because you might, if you dip a wheel onto that the wet part of a circuit, one, it cools the tyre down, which is horrible for a slick tyre, and two, all your grip goes. And we saw again what happened to Angular, the Stroza, what happened to Mazda. You have to be wary of where the dry part of a circuit is.
BMW's race going from bad to worse. They picked up some kind of a penalty down there in 12th place. Didn't see what that was, so presumably it must be a corner cutting or a track limit penalty, which is awarded automatically in the game. On board we ride here with Subaru, still closing up onto the back of Mercedes, but not having the straight line speed to try and do anything about getting themselves up into 5th place. Oh, how the tables have turned for them. Remember, a couple of years ago, they were, of course, the manufacturer's champions back in 2020. And, well, it's been a hard-fought task for them to try and repeat that crown here in 2022.
Did I just hear someone have a crash in the background there? I heard some, what I thought was some contact there in the background, but might have just been my imagination. We have been here for a couple of days now. Let's call it this. But
all you hear is tyre squeal after about 45 minutes these days.
Yeah, so they've got Honda and VW duking out for P7 at the moment. VW going to look around the outside. No, that's a sensible thing to do from here, because there are still some parts of the circuit. There are a little bit. Actually, no, it looks like the track is pretty much entirely dry now. Just a tiny little bit on the edge of the circuit, still wet as we go up towards the Lacombe here, the chicane. So will VW go for a move here, coming into the right hand and not quite close enough? They're on the brakes there. It's quite far back for a move. They're side by side. Bit of contact there. Honda sent over the incident. Now it's wet out there. Be careful rejoining. Yeah, they're okay back on again. But yeah, a little bit aggressive there, I think.
Le Boutelet doing a really good job, actually, of just giving back that position, not taking any prisoners there, but tries to immediately retaliate into the next corner, down into Rivage they go, and Volkswagen eventually get themselves up into 7th place. I suppose you could argue that they, of course, would have had the momentum from driving the normal line, wouldn't they, going through there for Volkswagen. And do you remember back in 2008 when Lewis Hamilton got punished for something similar? He went off at the bus stop chicane going, I think it was past Felipe Massa, and then went back up the inside into the source, and the FIA went, oh, you can't do that because you carried more momentum by going off the track.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, basically, don't do naughty things.
Don't do things that make you look bad, Jimmy.
Hey, sorry, I forgot. The Genesis now right at the back of Toyota. 0.4 of a second is the gap. Toyota, though, what a rocket that thing is in a straight line. Any time the Genesis gets close, it's horrible for Lisp saying that, by the way. Toyota just drives away again in the straight line. It's really hard for the car to find a way through. So obviously that's part of manufacturers. The cars have different strengths and different weaknesses. And Sasaki is doing a fantastic job, though, of keeping anywhere near the Toyota in front. And of course, we do still have another driver and another stint yet to come. So really, if you're anywhere close to the Toyota, it still means that your teammate can fight for that win towards the end.
So here we see Genesis then, the gap sort of ebbing and flowing, it decreases down in the middle sector where that Genesis looks really, really strong. Toyota there, as you can see, still leading the way, 0.8 of a second it sits as they come into Eau Rouge and Radial. We're now over half race distance. All the drivers have all made one pit stop, started on the intermediate tyres, bar Toyota, who were on the extreme wet. So I have to say, this race has worked out quite nicely for them. Of course, they have benefited from that huge incident for Porsche, who were leading the race. They are now all over the gearbox of Nissan for third position. Let's see whether Angel Stroza can repay the favour on Okamoto as he comes up the rise of the Kemmel straight. Okamoto knows that goes to the defensive line. Porsche and Stroza not trying to do anything too rash as they come in towards the right and then the left. Maybe just trying to use the momentum for a latter part of this lap. But all the while, they're kind of stuck behind. It is, again, just rubbing salt into the wound here for Team Porsche. What might have been for the German mark?
It can happen, though. You know, this is why endurance racing is all about consistency, just keeping the car on the road. We say, as long as you stay out of the pit lane, as long as you stay out of the wall, that's fine. It doesn't matter what your pace is. Just keep the car on the dry stuff in this case, in this these mixed conditions. You can see in the Stroza, he's pretty good in this mid-speed here. That MR layout of the Porsche, I think, really suiting those mid-speed corners. But the Nissan just seems to be planted everywhere. And of course, the Nissan is a chunky boy, so it's quite hard to find a way around that car in front. But again, through the exit there, in the Stroza's got the pace, but I mean, the Nissan just pulls away slightly.
Yeah, the Nissan looks to be pretty handy in a straight line. I mean, as you say, turbo grip. What is it you said? I'll never forget that line. couple of months back, you said you've got the aerodynamic properties of a two-bedroom house.
Yeah, it's something similar to that, but it's also got the it's also got the grunt to match it, so it doesn't matter. So yeah, coming out of Stapolo 1, Stapolo 2 there, just pulls away slightly, and you know that gap is enough that Inostroza will not be able to have a lunge now down into the bus stop. So it's all about setting the move up here. Behind us, we have Mercedes AMG's only about 2 seconds behind us on board now with Inostroza, so he's got to be wary of that at the same time as looking forward.
Jimmy, I've just been looking at the sky. Those clouds are getting a little bit darker and a little bit more ominous. Yeah. It does look like it, doesn't it? And the sun sort of beginning to fade away. Look at that. There's a few grey clouds coming up ahead again. I don't think too much to worry about at this particular stage, and the drivers aren't going to be necessarily thinking about it. Well, hopefully they won't be. But as we come up to two-thirds distance here in this race, it will quite literally be on their radar if there is anything to be concerned about. You can see, though, here the battle for the race lead between Toyota and Genesis still reigns on. Again, it's ebbing and flowing, but Genesis not within any sort of meaningful distance. Yuto Sasaki trying his best to close up onto the back, but the straight line speed of that Toyota, I mean, it has been a real talking point of the season, and that proves to be the case here as they come through into Lake Coombe again.
If you see in the midsection, they're just not quite as quick as the other cars, but around here at Spa, where there's, you know, a lot of flat-out driving, Sector 1, Sector 3, and meanwhile, sorry, we'll come back to that, Porsche around the outside of Nissan, and they go wide there, just trying to get the move done. Okamoto did do a good job of keeping the Porsche on the outside, but that would be very frustrating there for Angel Inostroza.
Yeah, disappointment there for the Chilean driver. I think we're going to go over to Julia in a few moments' time and see if we can get an update on the weather, because Julia looks like the times are changing up in the skies.
Yes, I don't want to worry anybody, but actually there's some pretty threatening looking cloud out there, so might be a good time to start thinking about that strategy, because it's not looking good up ahead, guys.
Weather radar looks okay down there for now, so you know, maybe Julia's just a doomsday, I don't know, but the weather radar looks okay. But if there is anything coming, the guys will know about it. You can have that weather radar to be fairly far out. So, I mean, you see the heavy wet tyres from the right available tyres here, it makes me wonder if something's coming or not. But
You can see visibly here, Jimmy, like the sheen on the cars just from looking at the circuit from this angle.
Oh, yeah,
it's not as bright as it was. It almost looks like the cars are in a matte paint finish, and those clouds are definitely coming overhead. This is going to be squeaky bum time here for these drivers, because of course they've got to consider their final driver strategy. They don't want to make more than the necessary amount of pit stop that they have to. If they go and decide to pit and go on to the hard combat of tyres and then the weather chucks it down, well, they're going to be out of sequence, and then they're going to have to make another pit stop and go back to their first driver, and they'll be all out of sync.
Yeah, as a UK resident, I'm more than familiar with the grim overcast skies. It's such very familiar to what comes just before a big old rain shower, but it remains dry for now, so you can only work the information you have, the conditions you have. A good friend of mine says, don't get too tricky with your strategy, so just think about what's going on now. You have a dry track in front of you, you're on a dry tyre, make the most of it. Don't think about the clouds too much until you start seeing your radar change. Here are the live point standings right now. Toyota would just smash it out of the park and be champions by quite a long way. But we've seen issues before. We saw Porsche leading and spinning. There's nothing to say this might not happen to Team Toyota. Genesis being quite close to them, you know, there's a chance maybe there'll be some sort of contact there. Who knows? But still a long way left in the race to go.
Yeah, plenty of opportunity for things to change. Neil still not at two-thirds distance. Here is Takumi Miyazono. You see him in the bottom left-hand of your picture at the moment, currently piloting that Subaru. I have to say one thing, if the weather does begin to change, and as I say, it gets greyer and greyer the more we seem to be talking about it, that Subaru, I happen to know from talking to the drivers, very, very handy in the wet conditions.
Handy in the wet conditions, but also about 12, 13 seconds behind the leader. So,
hello, there's the wipers.
Wipers on already and off again. Do you reckon he's trying to bait us? I think he is, but maybe press the wrong button. I've done that a few times, press the wrong button there trying to get the car in, but back on goes the wiper. So I don't know, maybe there's a little bit coming down now. We can't quite see it yet. Although we can see small drops of rain there, actually. So we are starting to get a little bit more rain here at Spa, and the drivers will know this already. So this is where it gets confusing for our drivers and for strategies.
It's starting to get cloudy.
So team radio there starting to get cloudy.
Yes, it is. I'm taking care of it.
Yeah.
And if the water gauge goes to one-third, if you think that it's approaching one-third, just go to the pit and we put the intermediate.
Okay. All right, so discussing the team strategy there for Toyota. They don't want to blink too soon. And the thing is, they're in the lead of the race. They are the car that is going to come to these conditions first of all. So they're almost the guinea pig for everybody else at this stage. And if the rain does come down, they're going to be arriving on it straight away.
Yeah, that is the tough thing when you're leading. You want to make the safe decision. You don't want to be making these big risks. And I don't know if it's going to have a big rain shower, it's just going to be very brief, who knows. But on the slick compound tyre, it's going to get tricky very, very quickly. So this is where experience comes into play. This is where knowing your car comes into play, knowing the circuit, knowing where you can put it in these conditions. So Toyota right now leading still from a second from Team Genesis. And this is the chance if you're someone like Nissan, for someone like Porsche or Mercedes. Look at that weather radar there in the bottom left-hand corner. All those little blue spots there, that's rain. And that's coming over right now. So obviously Spa's a big circuit. So in some parts of a circuit, it might be wetter than others. And we don't know what rate is coming down at the moment. Lexus already coming in for the intermediate compound tyre. I think it's a bit too early. We're not seeing any spray yet. You'd be surprised how long a slick can last in damp conditions. It's just about keeping that temperature in the tyre.
Mercedes there, and you can see the Baptiste Bavois, who's ready to take to the final stint of this car, was just going over and actually having a word in person with Sobi, who is driving that machine at the moment. So we're keen to see what is going to play out here. This could be a bit of an opportunity for redemption for Team Porsche and Angelo Nistrosa if they call the race right. They are, of course, some 11, 12 seconds off the back of Toyota, but if they call the strategy right, it might allow them to just close up that gap a little bit. Lap 19 and the 30 we're on. We're coming towards two-thirds race distance, and now it is getting really spicy with 10 laps to go. We're coming into the last pit stop window, effectively, for these drivers and the manufacturers. Two of them have already gone on to the intermediate tyres very early, we might add, as well. And the crucial question is here, when do you blink? And if you do blink, you don't want to do it too soon, because you don't need to be doing more pit stops than you need to, because if you go onto the intermediate tyres now, you burn them up and then they wear out, and you're absolutely screwed. Whereas if you do it later, and you do it too late, it's exactly the same thing. You need to time it right, and there is such a window of opportunity here for some of the manufacturers that perhaps have not had such a good race, but there's also such an opportunity to make a complete mess of it.
Fairly heavy rain now on the windscreen of the Porsche in front, so it's starting to come down heavy here at Spa-Francorchamps in our world finals here in the Manufacturers' Cup. Team Nissan in front at the moment.
Leaders are in, Jimmy.
Here they are, Toyota in for the intermediate, as are Genesis, Nissan and Porsche coming in as well. So everyone decided to go into the intermediate compound tyre, so there'll be a driver swap as well. Every time you come into the pits for a tyre swap, you do have to do a driver swap as well. That's in the regulations. And the top are coming in, Mercedes and Subaru going straight onto that wet compound tyre, as are VW. So strategically, this is massive, because our current points leader is on a different tyre from their closest competitors behind. So this could be, again, a masterstroke from those on wets, or it could be horrible.
Well, if it's a deluge rather than a downpour, Mercedes, Subaru and Volkswagen are in the pound seats, because, of course, they've saved about 25 seconds by not making another pit stop. If it is only a downpour, though, it's advantage to the top four as it stands. Everybody has now made their second and final stop in this race. Now, all the drivers are either on the intermediates or the wet tyres, and could we see a masterstroke of strategy here from not only Mercedes but Subaru and Volkswagen as well? Could it not only change the complexion of this race but the complexion of who becomes the Manufacturers' Cup champions of 2022? In this race so far, it has been Toyota who have reigned supreme, and I mean that quite literally, because they have just been absolutely unbelievable in terms of their driver performance, and they could be set to become three times Manufacturers' Cup champions. However, if they've called the tyre strategy wrong and gone for the intermediates when there is a massive downpour, it could be set to cost them very, very dearly.
Yes. No, I agree with that. I mean, at this point, it's really hard to call. I mean, you just have to hope you've picked the right compound attire. And you can, again, only drive to the conditions you have there. You do have radar information, which is, you know, mostly accurate from what I'm told in the GT there. A little bit of sort of leniency on that, of course. But it doesn't mean that being on that wet tyre and going to that straight away is the right call, because, as Tom said, you might just burn it up. But meanwhile, Mercedes and Subaru, this is where Subaru said they're going to be strong on these difficult conditions with that downforce. It just means they're better braking, better turning, all that stuff. But they're stuck up behind Mercedes right now. And if they're going to make the most of these conditions, if it rains more, then they need to get by Mercedes and just get on with it, just have clean air. So right now, your standings with 10 laps to go, Toyota, Genesis, Nissan. And Nissan up 8 places from their grid slot. So thank you, Nissan, for showing you are actually the GOATs. And Porsche, after a big error there from Angelina Stroza on the middle stint, down to fourth, what was a comfortable lead. We're going to keep an eye on sector times and give you an idea of who's quicker right now. Unsurprisingly, it seems the intermediate runners are quicker than the full rep runners.
Look at this. Subaru versus Mercedes. Sorry to go in front of you there, Jimmy. Side by side, they go. Subaru elevating themselves up to fifth place. So Mercedes and Baptiste Beauvoir struggling. Kilian Drumont and Subaru using the mechanical grip of that BRZ to try and take advantage. But Baptiste Beauvoir is not taking that one lying down. Side by side, they go into La Source. Baptiste is trying to hold it around the outside, but Kilian's wise to that. As they come out of La Source, they're going to go 2x2 on the run down the hill and into Eau Rouge and Radion. Which one of them is going to relent? Well, Baptiste has got the advantage for now and holds firm into fifth place. And as they come up the rise onto the Kemmel Straight, will we see the Mercedes pulling away? And will we see the lack of straight line speed hampering that Subaru then? Let's see as we ride on board. Baptiste knows that, goes for the defensive line in the Mercedes. Subaru and Kilian Drumont pull to the outside as we come into the braking zone of the Les Coupes chicane. Can Kilian hold it around the outside? Let's see as he comes into the right hander, then flicks it left. He can. Brilliant move there from Kilian Drumont. Can Baptiste retaliate into the next right hander of turn seven? He tries his best, but Drumont manages to get ahead and gets himself and Subaru up into fifth place.
Look at that rain really coming down now. You see Subaru by taking a slightly wider line there, staying off the racing line, which is actually quicker than Baptiste Beauvoir on the traditional racing line. So it is getting very wet. I see the rain really, really coming down now here at Spa-Francorchamps. And you must be wondering, if you're on that intermediate compound attire, was that the right call?
Well, having a look at the lap times here, Jimmy, and crucially the sector times as well. The wet tyres, it's kind of even Stevens at the moment. I don't think there's too much in terms of the crossover point though. And the thing is, if the rain continues in this intensity, it is only going to get worse. Nissan have picked up a half second penalty here as well. That's going to cost them in terms of time, but also relative in terms of position for Porsche here, because Porsche are right on their rear wing, and a big slide there as well, coming through the pit path for Benny Hafini, and it's going to drop them out of third place. And now they're going to have to try and get themselves back past Porsche.
Yeah, so Jose Serrano there at the wheel of the Porsche. This is actually good for them. They've been sort of stuck behind Nissan for the last few laps, so they'll get a bit of a freebie here. Nissan takes a penalty, back they go. Goodbye, Porsche, up into P3 then. Now, does Jose Serrano have enough pace underneath him to try and bring down this gap? It's 11 seconds to the lead, 10 seconds there to Genesis in front. It's going to be a massive ask there for the Spaniard. I don't think it's really possible under these conditions, but, I don't know. Subaru behind on the wet tyre. They seem to be the one to watch at the moment, because they are on the right tyre, in my opinion, if this rain continues. And it might well be that Subaru claw their way back up through the field. There's Nissan in front, so only about 2 seconds, or 3 seconds, sorry, between the two. Can Subaru claw back the gap?
Well, Volkswagen have dropped behind Honda there. Honda, of course, on the intermediate compound of tyre, but again, we wait to see whether this is going to be the right tyre call. 8 laps now remain. It is really going to get close. And I have to say, in terms of the lap times here, Jimmy, it's looking pretty interesting here too.
Subaru, from what I can see there, were the second fastest on track after Porsche. So, Porsche on the inters, Subaru on the wets. Work that out.
Yeah, again, it's going to come down to when that crossover period comes. Again, the rain is coming down. You can see the wipers coming into it now, and also the standing water getting ever more present as these rain continues and the track gets ever wetter. So I'm really, really keen to see how this is going to work out. And the thing is as well, Subaru are now closing up onto the back of Nissan. Last time around, it was Subaru with a 228.4, Nissan on the intermediate tyres in fourth place, a 229.8. There was some 1.4 seconds faster. And of course, with Nissan, there's a possibility for that supermarket deal, two for the price of one, because Porsche are right up ahead as well.
This is going to be an interesting one. Two groups of cars coming together now, two different strategies. Subaru and Mercedes on the wet, Porsche and Nissan on the intermediate. They are being caught at the moment by this little second group. The top three at the moment seem to be sort of stuck from where they are. Genesis actually getting a cut track penalty there, I think, a 0.5 second penalty. That put them slightly further behind Toyota. And if you're in the top four, you're just hoping for no more rain, because these inters are going to have a limit of how much water they can handle before they start skating around.
But look at the rain, Jimmy. Look at it. I mean, it is absolutely pouring down here. And these drivers are really going to be... Oh, the thing is as well, also to consider, is the circuit's going to be changing corner by corner, lap after lap, isn't it? And it's going to be an ever-evolving thing for the drivers to have to contend with, but it is going to change the complexion of this race. The thing is though, if you're Toyota, I mean, what have you got? Let's see, 11 seconds over Porsche and Genesis, there and thereabouts.
what do you do in this set of circumstances? Do you just try and continue on, or do you come in for the wet tyres and cut your losses and then hope that you're quicker?
Well, you can see, look at the circuit, you can see just a little bit of a drier line there, and actually a Toyota opting to take the wetter line there. Out of the corner, but you want to try and stay on that. That's where the most grip is going to be at this point. This is what shows his line through this right-hander here.
We're at the crossover point, Jimmy. Toyota last time around, 234.2. Let's keep an eye out and see what the wet runners are going to be able to do. Yeah, Subaru, 231.9. 3 seconds of a difference in lap times. This is where the intermediates are going to be absolutely useless from now on if this rain continues.
Yeah, well spotted there. So, Kokeburn there, you see, struggling big time, actually, for Arouche, having to get out of the throttle there. Massive understeer. This could be a massive moment here then in the World Finals here for the Manufacturers Cup. We're seeing now those intermediate tyres. The majority of the field have gone for a start to be overwhelmed by the amount of water on circuit. Same with Subaru, your Mercedes, your Volkswagen. You're in the right position right now, and Subaru are catching hand over fist on Nissan. Almost a second now is the gap between the two. 2 seconds, sorry. But that's come down for about 4 seconds, and Mercedes is going with them. So we'll keep an eye on their other lap times. You can see there, if you're on a wet compound tyre, you're smiling. Subaru, much quicker than the intermediate runners.
Volkswagen also taking advantage of that wet tyre. They've just elevated themselves up into seventh ahead of Honda then. So good news for Volkswagen. Can they try and make some more forward progress in the closing stages of this race? Seven laps remain here at Spa-Francorchamps in the Manufacturers' Cup Grand Finals. And it is all eyes on the race leaders. The top four of the competitors in this race are on the intermediate tyres, but they're coming towards the end of their shelf life now because these wet tyres are really coming into their own with more sand and water.
Things, all you can do on the intermediate is stay out. If you pit now, you're going to be massively out of position. You're going to lose so much time doing that. So you have to just stick with the tyre you have. And look now, Subaru, 1.2 seconds behind Team Nissan. Now, last time I looked, that was 2 seconds. So they are on an absolute charge. In front of them, Team Porsche. So Subaru might be in contention for a podium here. Now, bear in mind, they were tied with Toyota going into the Manufacturers' Cup. They lost a few points in round one. All it takes is a small mistake from Toyota. In fact, I think if Subaru finished ahead of Toyota on the circuit, they would be champions.
I think you could be right, yeah. I'm just having a look at that, you know, because there's a possible opportunity here for Subaru to maybe, surprisingly, take back the crown. Look at this contact here between Volkswagen and Subaru to Rivage. And, yeah, well, I mean, a warning was given there that was under investigation. It's a bit of a slam dunker, unfortunately.
Sad if you're a Team Honda member today. That's not the way you want to have your race decided. But here we are now. And that's third to sixth in your screen. Look at the drier part of a circuit. It's just a sheet of water at the moment. If you're on the intermediate, you touch that, you're going to have a very, very bad time. Unsurprisingly, a 2 second penalty they're given to Volkswagen, but they're kind of out of the equation at this point. So we won't pay too much attention to that. On board now with Team Subaru, you can hear the rain just smashing down on the windscreen, on the metal of our car as well. So we get such a better exit than Nissan does, but again, we're just struggling for that straight line speed. Let's have a look for Arouche and Randall now. This is where this car is going to be quicker compared to the Nissan. Still on board there. Let's have a look. There's Nissan in front, and we're seeing Lexus and Honda deciding. Oh, Porsche off there at the top of Arouche and Randall. Porsche off, and Nissan slow. Subaru goes from fifth to third in just one corner. Now they're going to have the speed though. And Nissan off. Sideways they go. They hit the wet stuff. Off they go. Mercedes with a 0.5 second penalty as well. So now Subaru are right back in this. There is Genesis in front, only 4 seconds on the road.
Yeah, now the tyres are really starting to not work at all. They're starting to aquaplane. Just to give you an idea, last time around, 236.3 for Toyota. On the west for Subaru, a 233.5. They were 3 seconds faster. This race is Subaru's to lose now at this point. Half second penalty there for Mercedes won't be helping their challenge on the wet tyres from fourth place. You can see the live points rankings. Subaru could not only win this race, but they could be in with a shout after winning the Manufacturers Cup here. It's double points on offer, and depending what happens here for Team Toyota, if they lose not only one but a few positions here with Mercedes creeping up, they could be set for the win in the Manufacturers Cup in 2022. What a dramatic conclusion this could be set to be.
Yeah, Subaru do need Mercedes to go with them, and that 0.5 second penalty is going to be tricky. You can see there even the wet compound attire getting all out of shape for the exit of Lake Como. Team Subaru, Mercedes looking around the outside. They're a long way around. Not as much grip out there at the moment, unfortunately, for the Mercedes anyway. And Subaru now, again, another second taken out of Genesis in front. The front two cars are really struggling right now. Mercedes about to serve that 0.5 second penalty, but give it a few laps and Subaru is going to be on the back of Genesis and Toyota.
Well, they are sliding like a dog on a polished floor coming through these corners. Just no grip out there at all for these drivers. I have to say huge credit to Porsche at the moment, and crucially for Jose Cerrone. He's doing a good job of sticking with these wet runners for the time being. There's that half second penalty being served for Baptiste Beauvoir. Draws him into the clutches here of the Porsche team, and you can see here as well, I'm just having a look here because the Toyota are watching on.
Yeah, Igor's there, he's got his gloves on. Toyota into the pit lane, Toyota into the pits, coming in now for a set of wet tyres. Is that the right choice? They had the lead, they're not going to be able to claw back this gap, I don't think. So I don't know if that's the right choice or not there from Team Toyota. Genesis go up into the lead. Subaru in P2, Mercedes P3. If it finishes this way, Subaru are going to be champions. Why do they pit?
This is unbelievable. I mean, the best they could have done is stay out there, but I guess they were just trying to hope that they could get onto the wet tyres, get some grip. But the thing is, it's going to cost them massively because the field is bunched up. Look at that, they're going to be sixth place behind Nissan. This is huge for Toyota. They were all set to become three times Manufacturers Cup champions, and they've thrown it all away with the wrong strategy call. This is quite incredible. And look at this, Subaru, there you go. You can see it on your screen now. If it finishes as it is now, it will be Subaru crowned as Manufacturers Cup champions of 2022. Can you believe it?
I've got to do some maths here. So if Toyota get back up to P3, which is the best they can do, I think, considering they've got two like intermediate runners in front of them, where is that going to put them? Maybe they've worked this out. Maybe we've not seen something. There is Genesis slow, and Subaru is right. Look how slow Genesis are. There's nothing they can do on this intermediate compound. They're trying to defend, but they can't. The tyres just aren't there. Subaru, there's Mercedes there in the background, too, pushing Subaru. Mercedes up into P1. Subaru there getting biffed out of the way by Team Mercedes. There's four cars now scrapping for the lead.
Down in towards the left hander we go. Oh, Mercedes are off. Subaru goes through into the lead. Baptiste Beauvoir chucked it all away. Can you believe it? As they come running down in towards Huon. He's managed to keep it facing in the right way, but still, he's got himself down into fourth place. He's now got more of a gap to climb than he had just a couple of corners ago. But goodness me, what a dramatic conclusion to the race this is going to be. And there's still five laps left.
We're seeing about 2-3 seconds of that difference now between the wet tyre and the intermediate compound. Genesis, just there's nothing left in that car. They're just struggling to keep it on the black stuff at the moment and just about managing to do it. And not if you're Baptiste Beauvoir, who's now having to go back through these guys once again. Porsche and Genesis doing a good job keeping the car on the road, given the conditions. But now this allows Team Subaru just to put the hammer down and try and make a gap. Now we'll keep an eye on Toyota behind. They do need to come back through the field. They need to get up to third minimum, I think. But we'll try and get some point standings based on that soon. I'll see if I can get our director to let us know the points. But it's going to be tight.
This is really interesting. Toyota's gap between Nissan and themselves is 1.1 seconds or so there and thereabouts. We really need to see how this is going to play out. Look in front, though, between Porsche and Genesis as well. Two intermediate shot runners going toe-to-toe with one another as they come into the bus shot. Porsche on the outside, Genesis on the inside. They're going to flick it left. Genesis coming to the pit lane then. So they've decided they want to chuck off those wet tyres. The win is out of the question there for there now. Look at Toyota in the background. They've elevated themselves up into P5. So I suppose that's one crumb of comfort here for Team Toyota onto that wet compound of tyre, because crucially here, if everybody else on the intermediate tyres, Nissan and Porsche, come into the pits, it may be a saving grace. Let's have a look at turn 8 again.
Let's have a quick look at this. So Mercedes on the inside there, they've got it done. Baptiste Beauvoir in the lead, but I think he just gets on, just slides to the right there. Manages just about to keep it out of the wall, but that would have been a heart and mouth moment there for Baptiste Beauvoir, who's now up behind the Porsche of Jose Serrano. He's got the toe, he's got the drive through going. Baptiste Beauvoir back into second position. The gap now, though, 2 seconds to Team Subaru in front, and the Subaru is where it wants to be. It's out front, there's no one in front of it. There are the life point standards in the race, and there it was. Oh, a massive moment there for Baptiste Beauvoir. Couldn't get the car slowed down. He's over the runoff. He's given that, I think he's given the time back there, so it shouldn't be an issue. But massive moment there. Oh, he's given a 1 second penalty.
Can you believe it, Baptiste Beauvoir? That's a huge moment there for them and could cost them very dearly indeed. Here comes Subaru trying to side it down the inside into Rivage. On the inside they go. Can Jose Serrano make the move? Stick on the Frenchman. Yes, he can. And goes up into second place. What a crescendo this race is turning out to be. And look at Toyota there in the background. They are now just 1 second away from closing up onto the back of Mercedes, who of course have got that 1 second penalty. So they're going to get themselves up into third place. We've got to see a live point standing here to work this all out, haven't we?
Igor Fraga is absolutely charging. sitting in the tow till we came from grief. I didn't understand why they pit, but now they did. Igor is pushing that car to the absolute limit. He's got to get back up into second place for Toyota to win the series. And all he's got to do is get by Mercedes and Porsche. Look at the concentration there on the Brazilian's face. He knows what needs doing. Just very, very carefully threading the car through the corners and it already onto the back of Mercedes AMG. You still have a penalty. He's going to be able to be free here. And then it's just Jose Serrano. Can Jose Serrano on the intermediate tyres hold off Igor Fraga?
I don't know if he's going to be able to do it. The thing is, the rain is still coming down. It's still pretty heavy. There's still a lot of standing water. Look at the tracks on the moment. Look at the big moment there for Baptiste Beauvoir. That allows Toyota to go through and into third place. Beauvoir's had a couple of warning signs now. He needs to take it a bit careful and possibly could be set to lose another place. Here's a Nissan. Life points rankings on your screen. It's still not enough for Toyota. They need P2 or better to become the champions of 2022. Their next target, though, thankfully for them, is going to be Team Porsche up the road in second, who are on the intermediate tyres and look like they're going to go to the end.
Yeah, I'm fairly sure it's P2, so we'll just wait for confirmation on that. But it's getting now to crunch time. It's lap 27 of lap 30. Toyota and Igor Fraga closing in on Jose Serrano. Last lap by Igor Fraga was 3 seconds quicker than Porsche and 2 seconds quicker than Subaru in front. So he might be able to take the lead and take the win here.
Well, let's see, because it will be enough for them to tie on points with Subaru, because it's 4 points the difference between the checkered flag fell now. There's 4 points between the difference of second and third in the point standings. So I think it'll be enough for Toyota to tie on points, but I don't think it'll be quite enough for them to take the championship. And Porsche get a penalty for cutting the track there. Half-second penalty here for Jose Serrano and Team Porsche. Well, that is Christmas come early here for Igor Fraga, who needs 3 laps of his life to get himself ahead of Subaru to win the Manufacturers' Cup of 2022. Through Lake in we go, into the right-hander of Turn 7, on the run down into Rivage, and this is going to be an incredible end to this race. It is Subaru versus Toyota, with Porsche in the middle of that sandwich right now. And goodness me, what on earth is this going to look like when the checkered flag falls here?
I've got to give absolute massive credit to Jose Serrano. I know he's got a 0.5-second penalty there, but he's keeping that Porsche just about on the circuit with tyres that are not suited for these conditions. Though you can just see it's a matter of time before Igor Fraga gets there. That 0.5-second penalty would definitely just assist him on the way by. Running P3 currently, we'll have to see what the point standings are once he's by, but it's only going to be a few more corners, I think. 0.5 seconds is the gap now. You can see behind, that's not a sight you want to see in the wet. Look at the difference in performance there under braking between the tyres. Just able to just drive into the corner so much harder with so much more confidence. You can see Eagle, they're actually taking a wetter line, trying to stay off the dry stuff on the inside there to use the tyre better to effect.
So through the right-hander of Paul Freire, we're about to come on the run into into the bus stop, I should say. And you can see there, keeping a watching brief on proceedings, is Baptiste Beauvoir of Mercedes. We ride on board here. I have to say, Jose Serrano, as you say, is doing a really good job. But look at him feathering the throttle. There's just no grip out there on the intermediate tyres. And Igor Fraga is going to go siding through into second.
That was a 0.5-second penalty there, served by Porsche. Igor now up into second. The gap, 2.4 seconds. And there you go. Yeah, they'll be tied on points. But because Subaru win this race, they would be the champion. So it all comes down to this. It's Subaru versus Toyota. Whoever finishes first on track will be the Manufacturers' Cup champions here in 2022.
It's winner takes all then. You can see the graphic on your screen there now. Let's keep an eye on the lap times here between the two. Over the line, it was Subaru with a 2:38.172. Toyota, 2:37.5. So that was some 6 tenths of a second faster. The gap is just over 2 seconds coming to the third but last lap then here. And Igor Fraga has got the bit between his teeth. As I said, he needs the last few laps of his life here in this race. He doesn't need to start battling here with Jose Serrano. If he starts squabbling with him, that's his race over. That's Toyota's third Manufacturers' Cup title out of the window. And it will give the signal to Subaru. And off there goes Jose Serrano.
Oh, big crash.
And Nissan off two at the top of Eau Rouge. Big incident there. So Nissan will go tumbling down the order. And goodness me, Porsche. And how on earth did Jose Serrano keep that in a straight line? See how tentatively Beauvoir is going on the brakes there, trying to get that car stopped. Doesn't want to repeat of what it was like on the last lap, and he's now all over the gearbox here. of the 911.
Remember Salzburg time? It was Kilian Drumont versus Igor Fraga. It's Kilian Drumont versus Igor Fraga once more at the front of the field. The gap for the lead down to 1.5 seconds. Meanwhile, Mercedes doing everything they can to try and get by Jose Serrano here in that Porsche, but he's just sticking it on the racing line. Look at that weather radar. This rain is not going to relent. So here is a replay from Team Nissan. Just gets it all out of shape over the top here and it's just spat into the wall. That's a massive shunt.
Yeah, that's absolutely huge there for Team Nissan. And you can see that it has cost them dear indeed down into sixth place. But look at Mercedes then versus Porsche. Mercedes on the wet tyre, Porsche on the inters. They'll be going to the end. There's nothing more they can do now. They could be on for a podium finish here. Look at how close Baptiste gets under the brakes into the pit path. Then you can see just how much more grip he's got underneath in the rain. Still comes down in a very heavy intensity. I have to say though, Jimmy, the gap at the front, still 2 seconds, it's stabilising.
It's that middle sector, Tom. That middle sector, that Subaru is untouchable. When we get to the straights, we get to the third sector, where we are now, we get to the first sector and that Toyota is so strong, the straight line speed is massive, so just watch that gap, it will come back down again. But Baptiste just can't find a way by it. Jose is doing such a good job on those intermediate compound tyres. Everybody else in the inters is struggling massively, but somehow Jose is keeping the thing on circuit, and this must be an absolute just heartache here for Baptiste and Mercedes AMG. He needs to get by, needs to get after Toyota and Subaru. He just can't do it, they're too quick in front.
You can see how late Baptiste can brake on those wet tyres. Genesis picking up a penalty. Their race unfortunately has come undone in the closing stages of this one. There, some 16 and a half seconds off the back, and we thought they might be in contention for the win earlier on here. Sadly, it has not proven to be for the brand new manufacturer here. Penultimate lap time we go as we ride on board here with Baptiste.
Watch Toyota now for this first sector. This is where that car is strong. This is where we know the Subaru isn't. It doesn't have that grunt. So 1.7 seconds right now as we come onto the penultimate lap, coming down to Eau Rouge and Brandon for the first time. We know it is difficult through there. We've just seen Nissan end their race in the barrier. We look at Jose Serrano in front, just about managing to hold on to the car there. Subaru again using the downforce that comes to that car to get through Eau Rouge and Brandon a bit quicker than the cars behind. We're now looking at Mercedes AMG going in closer and closer to the Porsche in the real track. You can see just how wet it is. Baptiste Bobois looks to the outside.
No!
Oh, contact between the two there. Very messy, but I think I'd say Jose came over a little bit there.
Yeah, you could argue that, couldn't you? And thankfully, no harm done between the two, but Jose there just doing everything he can to keep that car facing the straight line and also keeping more pace than Baptiste Bobois, who doesn't seem to have a lot of confidence underneath him. Of course, it would prove to be the difference between third in the standings here between Porsche and Mercedes as well. If I know, actually, AMG would still get third place in the standings if it finishes as it is, so it doesn't really matter in that respect, but of course, they want to finish third and to get a podium in this race.
Just a reminder, if the race finishes as it is right now, Subaru will be your Manufacturers' Cup champions. They will tie on points with Toyota, 40 points apiece. If Toyota can get by, they will be champions. It's as simple as that. But I say the charge is starting to fade a little bit from Igor Fraga. The lap time, Toyota is slightly faster over lap, but only by about a couple of tenths of a second. But through this middle sector, the Subaru is just mighty. Up to 2 seconds again is the gap. He's running out of time. Only about a lap and a half left for Igor. Can he catch Kilian Drumont in the Subaru?
I said about that Subaru earlier on. I said it was really quick in the wet conditions. The mechanical grip of that BRZ really is impressive. And in the middle sector, as you said, Jimmy, that is where it counts. It sort of seems to ebb and flow, this gap, doesn't it? Goes up to about 2.2, comes down to 1.8 at different parts. But he's running out of opportunities now. We're ready to come and start the final lap. And unless Kilian Drumont makes an error, it's going to be the Subaru that will manage to claim the Manufacturers' Cup crown in 2022. You can see the points on the left-hand side of your screen. That's what's awarded. Double points on offer here for the grand final. Into the bus stop for the penultimate time. Here comes Mercedes on the inside of Porsche into the bus stop there. Baptiste trying to think about a move, but again, not too close. Not close enough to make that move stick.
Subaru had a mistake coming out of Stablo 2 there. That allowed Igor Fraga to get a bit closer in that Toyota. He's much closer than he was before. He was 6 steps faster than that. He's going to be in the draft this time. If he can get a good run out of the hair, but he might might be able to have a stab going into Lacombe. Let's see how it is. Subaru there, nice and neat and tidy out there. Behind him is Igor Frog in the Toyota. Porsche have got closer actually to the back of Toyota now. Porsche need to get by Toyota if they want to be on the podium here in the Manufacturers' Cup. But it's all at the front now. 1.3 seconds separate Subaru and Toyota. And Subaru quick through there. Oh, wow, Igor sideways over the top of Radion there. That's going to slow him down. And that is the breathing space that Subaru want.
Well, goodness me, he can cut the tension with a cricket.
Oh! Porsche are off on the Kemmel straight. That's going to be their chance for the podium overall here tonight. Absolutely done and dusted. Well, Jose Serrano, he tried as hard as he could. Thankfully, he managed to keep the car facing in the right direction, but it's been a valiant effort on those intermediate tyres. Sadly, it is going to be fourth that will be there. Result in a big slide there for Drumont out of turn seven. Goodness me, but the gap still sits at 1.8 seconds. What an amazing race this has proven to be. What a brilliant display of driving from our top two especially as well.
Yeah, it's not over just yet. It's still half a lap to go. We know these conditions can catch people out. We're in the middle sector now. This is where the Subaru is strong. This is where Killian just needs to keep it nice and neat and tidy, and he should be good. We're on board with Igor Fraga. There's not much more he can do through here. The Toyota just doesn't quite have the speed through that middle sector compared to the car in front. It's been a valiant effort from Toyota. I thought they threw everything away, but they did have to come in for the tyres. He came back through the field. He almost caught Subaru, but it's looking like it's not going to happen for Team Toyota.
I have to say, it has been a valiant effort from them to try and claim that third crown. One wonders what might have been had they not had to make that third pit stop, because they would have been in a different postcode compared to everybody else if they just managed to call the strategy right. But if buts and maybes are not going to end the story, and it is going to be Subaru who come through in the lead through the final series of corners. You can see their live points rankings. It would be a tie, but as we know, the champion is decided on this grand final result. And as Subaru would claim the win overall ahead of Toyota, they will take the crown. Just a couple of corners then from home. What a brilliant race this has been in the Manufacturers' Cup. We have had changeable weather, we have had incidents from start to finish, we have had a brilliant display of driving and skill here, and into the final corner comes Killian Drumont for Team Subaru. It is going to be Killian Drumont, Danny Solis, and the Kermit Solo who become Manufacturers' Cup champions of 2022. It's their second title. They won it in 2020. They win it again this year. What an amazing end to the race for Team Subaru against all of the odds. And those three drivers are on top of the world here in Monaco.
Baptiste Beauvoir there, just inconsolable. But at the other end of the spectrum here, here are Team Subaru. Drumont, Miazono, and Danny Solis. An awesome performance by them. Just called the strategy right there. Had the car underneath them. Dealt with the pressure from a charging Igor Fraga and Team Toyota to take. Oh, and they're down. They're down, Tom. They're down.
Well, they had to have an incident, didn't they, at some point? And thankfully, it came after the checkered flag. Penny for the thoughts of Ryota Kokkonen, of Igor Fraga, and of Nikita Moisov. A valiant effort it was from those three drivers. They tried as hard as they could, but they won the World Series showdown back in July, didn't they, Subaru, with a brilliant drive from Killian Drumont and Danny Solis. Takumi Miyazono sadly was not able to be there, but he is able to enjoy all of the glory here tonight and play a crucial role in their success story for them to become the champions.
Love to see it there, just handshakes at the end there. Great sportsmanship between our competitors. Awesome to see. And it must be hard when you're there in second place to go, you know what, mate, well done. You had the best of us today. But a valiant effort from Team Toyota. They made an extra pit stop and were only 2 seconds behind at the end. Really good run by them.
Absolutely incredible. Great to see everybody congratulating one another down there. And Danny Solis as well. I know we've spoken about it a lot during the World Series, but he was a driver who came from playing on a pad, on a controller, and has gone from that to becoming a world champion. Here we can see the opening stages of the race. It was Porsche who led the way. It was a risky strategy from Team Toyota. They started on the extreme wet tyres, and they, I have to say, had it all to do as Mazda ended up getting spun round and facing the wrong way after contact into Rivage.
If anything, Mazda won the competition for most spins this race, but Honda there go up into fourth place, just getting by BZW.
Please stand by. Maybe okay. I think I will do another lap and I'll go to pit for the hands.
into the pit lane. Then came Team Toyota, eventually getting off of those wet tyres at a normal stage. Great drive from Igor Fraga in the opening stint to keep it within. The track began to dry out. There was a massive moment between Volkswagen and Team Mazda as they went round like a tumble dryer in towards Rivage. And you can see also problems there for McLaren as Okamoto came out.
Told you, stay off the wet stuff. Follow the line.
Apologies, that was Inazato who came out of the pits and ended up going straight to the scene of the accident. Toyota managed to make their ascension through the field with a brilliant middle stint on the hard tyres for Nikita Moisov. And then Porsche and Engel and Estroza threw it all away. A big moment on the curve on the wet part of the track. Their lead was lost. It was Toyota with the advantage at two-thirds distance.
Wait, I think,
pit,
I don't know.
Pit?
Yeah, pit.
I think it will rain for the rest of the race. We go full wet.
Yeah. It was that choice in the end that pretty much won Toyota this championship. I think it's going to rain the rest of the race. Let's go full wet round the outside here of Team Mercedes, making it look easy in that Subaru. And then from there, it was just a matter of trying to keep the car on the straight and narrow and just try and keep the other cars behind. Here was Subaru, that's Nissan and Porsche. This is where they went from fifth to third in just one corner. Thank you very much. Through they go, but it just shows you how treacherous conditions were if you weren't on that right tyre.
You can see it was really treacherous when you weren't on the right tyre. Massive moments there. Toyota eventually had to throw the towel on lap 25. They went for the inters for their final stint. It was the wrong call. They had it all to do as it all kicked off into Rivage with all the drivers working it out. Baptiste Beauvoir briefly led for a corner and then threw it all the way at the very next opportunity into the left-hander of Ickx. You can see him there just getting a bit of a tank slapper on into the barrier. Subaru went through and then Mercedes was stuck behind Porsche for the remainder of that race as Toyota managed to get past Igor Fraga in the driving seat at this point on the extreme wet tyres through into second place. There was a bit of contact between Porsche and Mercedes here too.
And it's you're just about keeping on track there, but no lasting damage there. So the stewards kept it at that for there. But then Porsche had this massive moment, pretty much in a straight line, just showing how hard it was being out there on those intermediate tyres. But it was Team Subaru who would take the spoils here at Spa. Kylian Drumont taking the car to the line from Igor Fraga and
Let's
crowning
go!
Themselves the 2022 Manufacturers Cup champions.
Yeah, come on!
I reckon they're pleased, Tom.
You might be right. Team Subaru then take top honours, not only in the race, but in the Manufacturers' Cup Championship standings at the end of that one. Team Toyota, it was a valiant effort. They tried as hard as they could, but they finished second best, with Mercedes coming home in third place in that race. Team Porsche, well, they'll be disappointed with that one. Unfortunately for Team Genesis as well, it all came undone despite a promising middle stint. Volkswagen, Mazda, Honda, Lexus, McLaren, Nissan and BMW complete the order. Let's get final confirmation, shall we, of the point standings after that race. So after it all works out following a season, you can see that tied on points between Subaru and Toyota. But the winner takes all here tonight. It is Team Subaru who are champions of the world in the Manufacturers' Cup. Let's head down, shall we, and get the live reaction from our Manufacturers' Cup champions, Kylian Drumont, Danny Solis, Takuma Miyazono are down talking to Julia.
Well, I guess my very first question, which is incredibly British of me, but how was the weather?
The weather is very...
That was crazy, though.
It's proper control, you know? Yeah. Like the same way of life, so it's very complicated to pre-road the weather, so yeah.
How was it anticipating? Like, because obviously you sort of knew that maybe there would be something, so what were you thinking? What were you thinking in terms of strategy?
For the start of the race, he did the intermediates, or the middle, the hard, because the rain is away, and the rain is, again, incoming. So I say everywhere, I think it's a good strategy, because on the race, you didn't put the full wet tires. So for the race, it's mandatory to put that.
So. Well, I mean, it was exactly the right strategy, exactly the right thing. Danny, hi, welcome back. How are you?
Excited.
You're back here again.
Yeah, and this time champion on stage as opposed to 2020, so I'm really happy about that. Yeah. It felt a little hollow back then, so to be here now is just amazing.
What's it like being in the room? Like, do you feel like it affects how you drive?
I don't know. Usually I'm super nervous beforehand, but when I get in the seat, it's just full focus mode, and it seems to go okay. So,
casually awesome. I mean, just it's fine, it's totally fine. And Takuma, how was that for you? That was quite intense, having that weather this time. How did you find it?
あの、今回の天候変化、かなり厳しい状況だったと思いますけど、どうでしたか？はい、僕は
途中で1回スピンしてしまって、ちょっと10秒ぐらいロスしまったので、本当に何も言うことができないんですけど、結果的に本当にダニエルとキリアに助けてもらって、こうやってチャンピオンを取れたので、本当に2人のおかげだというふうに思います。
Yeah, you know, I made the mistake of, spinning in anger, in the last 10 seconds. So, you know, I don't have anything to say, but Killian and Daniel really saved the day and, you know, really helped us win. So I'm really thankful to them.
But this is what it comes down to. It's teamwork, right? It's not any one person. It's, you know, it's all together as a team, yeah?
やっぱり一人だけじゃなくて、チームワークが全てだっていうのが、よくわかる戦いですよね。
So I would also say that because obviously, you know, winning the Manufacturers Cup, you know that it means you have to be the first people into the dancing circle pit on Sunday night, right?
あの、日曜日に、ダンスのサークルに、1位で、まず飛び込まないといけないので、それを覚悟してくださいと。
Yeah, they've all given up arguing with me about it now. They just give up, they go limp, and they just get pushed into the circle to dance. It's very cute. I just want to say, should we give the massive, huge round of applause for our Manufacturers Cup winners, Team Subaru?
Oh, goodness me. Oh, Judy, you didn't have some one-liners. Huge congratulations to Team Subaru. Right, keep it together, keep it together. Okay, amazing job from Team Subaru. Huge congratulations to Killian Drummond, Danny Solis, and Takuma Miyazono to become double Manufacturers Cup champions. I mean, I don't even know where to start with that because there was so much going on in that race. I physically am exhausted. I dread to think what the drivers must be like.
I mean, it was interesting hearing what Daniel Solis said there about, like, this is now in person. It feels like a proper real victory, this. And I really hope that Miyazono doesn't sort of punish himself too much for his mistake. I mean, as Julia rightly said, it is teamwork. You need three drivers to get to the end of the race. They had three drivers, and between them, they won that thing. So, yeah, amazing. And also Drummond to withstand that pressure from Fraga. I mean, Fraga's been around for ever and ever, so to have him harrying you for the last few laps and just to take it like in a stride is amazing.
Yeah, really, well done. Let's be fair, Killian, of course, is incredibly young. I think he's 18, 19, something along the lines of that. You know, one of the youngest competitors we've got. So to get, as you say, somebody like Igor Fraga, who's been, you know, here since last century.
Igor's an old man.
He is, yeah, he's a walking stick in his bus parts, doesn't he, to be honest with you. Anyway, on the other side, though, if you are Team Toyota, what are your thoughts going to be after that one? I mean, you gave it as good as you got, didn't you?
I mean, it was a really tricky situation. I mean, the rain's coming down. You have to try and guess, yo, is it going to be wet for the entire race? Is it going to be a little shower? They went for the latter, and it just didn't work out for them. And, you know, I did sort of chastise their decision to change tyres, but it turned out to be correct. You saw the other intermediate runners just couldn't keep it on the road. And he almost got there, but just not quite.
Yeah, absolutely. And if you're Mercedes as well, of course, they managed to bag third overall in the standings, so they do finish P3 in the Manufacturers Cup in 2022. Do you think, I mean, we saw Baptiste at the end of that. He looked physically and emotionally drained.
I think he was just annoyed. I mean, like, I think that, you know, he took the lead. He could have won that race and that could have swung the results around. But that one mistake, I think, really cost him. And he knows that. Baptiste, you know, he's a very reflective person. He's someone that's been on the podium quite a lot here in these events and often with Mercedes. So I think he's hoping for that manufacturer to win at some point, but unfortunately not today for Mercedes.
And also for Team Porsche, again, on the other side of the coin. I mean, they were, let's be fair, a shoe-in for the victory. And again, a simple mistake from Inostroza, you know, completely not intentional, not his fault. I get that, you know, onto the curb, wet part of the track, it happens. It's one of those things, but it did cost them not only a chance of victory, but also a chance of the overall podium.
Just go show how tricky the conditions were. You know, if someone like Angel Inostroza, someone who's so used to that car, makes that mistake, then it shows you how tricky it is out there.
And how good was it to see the emotion of all of the drivers? That's what I love about this being in person, because obviously we've done it remotely for such a long time. Look here at Team Subaru, and you can see the delight of them becoming the champions for the Manufacturers Cup this year.
I want to see him go down, that was quite funny. It all just fell over, but yeah, an awesome moment there. I mean, this has been the first time we've had a world final at Monaco for a while, so it's nice to be back here. And they're contrasting emotions. Baptiste both wild, just super upset. And again, you can't blame him. You can't blame him. Reflective. And I think he knows that it's on him.
Standout performance of the
evening for you in terms of race one and also the grand final?
Oh, it's really difficult. I think for me, it was just the it was probably Killian at the end there to get back through the field, to take advantage of the time. And he didn't just magically appear in first place. He had to go and earn it. So he fought for that place and then just pulled away from at the end there. So I think Killian Drummond for that drive just magnifique.
And of course, some of these drivers aren't done yet. We've had the Manufacturers' Cup. We've got the Nations' Cup here tomorrow as well. The thing is, that's a very different kettle of fish.
Yeah, that's a lot more aggressive than I tend to find. We've had some aggression here today and over the last couple of days, but Nations Cup tomorrow, I think it's the crescendo of our weekend. Like, I can't wait for it. It's going to be amazing.
Yeah, it really, really is. Well, I say huge congratulations to Team Subaru, to Team Toyota, and to Team Mercedes-AMG for, of course, becoming those top three finishers. We're not far away from the podium celebrations here, and I have to say, if it's anything like what we had last time when we were in Salzburg, it's going to be a bit of a cracker.
Yeah, I mean, we've got to be careful in the evening because we're working tomorrow.
Yeah.
But yeah, these guys go hard in the evens.
They have to be careful as well, because last time we nearly ended up having a confetti nearly caught alight when we had the confetti and we had the sparks coming down. It was like, oh, this is great. And they were like, oh, hang on a minute. There's a brief moment of panic, but hopefully I'm sure that will not happen tonight. But we are now ready for the podium ceremony here for the Manufacturers' Cup for the GT World Series World Finals. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome in third place from a team, say Mercedes-AMG, it is Lucas Benelli, Baptiste Beauvoir, and Shinsuke Savoy! In second place, please welcome Team Toyota, Nikita Moisov, Ryota Cockerman, and Igor Fraga! Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your 2022 Manufacturers' Cup Champions of the World for Team Subaru. It's Killian Drummond, Danny Solis, and Takuma Miyazono! And now our national anthem for the winning manufacturer of Japan. Well, huge congratulations to Team Subaru, the Manufacturers' Cup champions of 2022. It is now time for the awards to be presented. In third place, presenting the award is the COO of Sony AI, Michael Spranger, and it is presented to Lucas Benelli, Baptiste Beauvoir, and Shinsuke Savoy of Team Mercedes-AMG. The second place trophy is presented by Maro Piccoloi, the Chief Marketing Officer of Brembo, and it is presented to Nikita Moisov, Ryota Cockerman, and Igor Fraga of Team Toyota! And the first place Champions Trophy is presented by Katanori Yamauchi, the Gran Turismo series producer. The trophy is presented to Killian Drummond, Danny Solis, and Takuma Miyazono of Team Subaru!
honestly, that was, I never thought we would be here at Gran Turismo discussing the weather live on stream, but here we are.
I was disappointed you didn't do a fast show thing with the weather map.
Scorchio, Claudio,
all of that.
I thought you'd think that, yeah. Though it was amazing that all of a sudden just everything that we know about the Manufacturers' Cup just totally turned on its head.
It's what I like about endurance racing, you know, that nothing is set in stone, especially the weather. It's great to see that addition now in these events as well. And it was the deciding factor of this race. Those who called it right, Subaru, they won the whole thing. So Toyota got it wrong, second.
I mean, though, it's still super close, even with the sort of the tyre strategy not being perfect. It was, what was it down to right at the end about? Like, was it 1.5? Just, it was close, right?
2 seconds.
Well, you have to wonder what would have been, though. I mean, if Toyota had got the strategy called right in the first place, you wouldn't have seen them for, you know, for dust.
There you go. So plan for the weather, and we're British, so we always plan for every kind of weather because you can't decide. Anyway, moving forward, don't forget to vote for your Michelin driver of the day. Look at these handsome chaps. Go on there, vote for the driver of the day, and we will announce it tomorrow. There's been some amazing driving today, to be honest. It's very hard to pick, I'm not going to lie.
In my vote, it's for Killian. I think he had an awesome driver at the end there, so my vote be for him. But
you don't get a vote. I told you about this before. I'll have to go online later and vote, won't I? No, you're not allowed to.
All right, well, I won't then.
Get the stewards with a big stick out on you again, Jimmy.
Yeah, that's honestly... Well, we need to keep off the internet most of the time anyway, so yeah. Well, look, we have been... we've been so happy to have you here with us for this Manufacturers' Cup. It's been... Like, I've got to say, that was one of the best finals. I really enjoyed that.
Can we have rain for every race, please?
Yeah, can we? Why did we not do weather before?
Shall I have a word?
Yeah. Have a word. Right. We'll get a sternly worded email together from the three of us and we'll see what we can do. Thank you so much for joining us. And thank you to everyone here at Gran Turismo and the team that bring it to you. We will see you again for the big one, which is the Nations Cup final. Are you ready, guys? I don't know if I'm ready. It's been spicy too much.
Lego!
We'll see you tomorrow.
We'll be right back. Sorry, guys, sorry.
That's okay. You kept the toe. It's probably faster.
Come on, McLaren. Accelerate.
Floor speed.
Floor speed.
Oh!
Oh, no.
No.
Oh, that's a huge pen.
Let's go, mate. Well done, Sasaki. Well done, mate. Well done. Who was that?
Please stand by. Maybe okay. I think I will do another lap and I go to pit for the hands.
I told you stay off the wet stuff. Follow the line.
I think it will rain for the rest of the race. We go full wet.
Yeah. We'll be right back.
If you have opened up GT7 in the past couple of days, you will see that it has been updated for the World Finals. We're celebrating Gran Turismo's 25th anniversary in style. And if you enter the 25th anniversary races, you will be gifted a X2019 in a stunning special livery. You can also get closer to the action by competing in the exact same races as our 2022 World Finals drivers. If you think you can predict who will be our 2022 World Champions, click on the bonus campaign for your chance to win credits. And if you're watching our streams, then click on the viewers campaign within the next 24 hours for your chance to win by answering a question you can only know the answer to if you're watching. See you in GT7.
Sorry guys, sorry.
That's okay. You kept the toe. It's probably faster.
Come on, McLaren. Accelerate.
Floor speed.
Floor speed.
Oh! Oh no!
No!
Oh, that's a huge pen.
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening. Welcome to the Sporting Monte Carlo, where we are here for the press conference following the 2022 Gran Turismo World Series Manufacturers Cup Finals. And I am delighted to welcome our top three finishers in the standings. Of course, Team Mercedes-AMG in third, Team Toyota in second, and Team Subaru in first place, who've become double Manufacturers Series champions. Let's start off by asking some questions, first of all in reverse order, and you guys can decide amongst you who answers these questions. So third place for Team Mercedes-AMG. Just talk us through your thoughts and feelings after finishing in third place.
まずは3位のメルセデス AMG から今回のレースについて説明をお願いしますと。で、好きな人から喋り始めてもらって大丈夫です。
Que que você acha terem ficado em terceiro lugar? Quais são as sensações que você tem?
Ah, foi fantástico ter terminado no pódio, mas era tudo possível ali, tanto conseguir o primeiro lugar quanto o segundo, mas o terceiro é muito bem-vindo também.
Muito bem.
Oh, sorry. Not used to this. So, Lucas was saying that we tried everything. It was nice to finish on the podium. It could have been better, but it's okay, third place.
Wonderful. Well, thank you very much, Lucas. Baptiste, let's just ask you a quick question. That final stint in particular looked really, really tricky for you. Just talk us through it from your point of view, because you look quite dejected after the checkered flag.
Well, I think we did I was scared to not make it the right choice about the tire. I was thinking that's going to be Inter tire again for the last stint. At the end, we did the right choice. I know that AMG was not the fastest car in the rain. I tried my best. I could follow Subaru. I tried to overtake them. It worked, and I did a mistake maybe 2 seconds after. I'm really sad about this mistake, but today I think everyone here will never forget this race. We all, I think, enjoy it. I'm a bit sad for Porsche too, because I will have loved to finish the battle without a crash from them, but yeah, it was a really, really good race, and it's a better result for us than last year, so we are happy.
Wonderful. And Shinsuke, let's ask you a question. Just talk us through your perspective. How did you feel after managing to claim a podium for Mercedes?
Mercedes のあのポディアム表彰台に乗って今の感想をお願いします。
そうですね。今日のレースは正直自分のミスが一番効いてると思ってますけど、その僕のミスを挽回してくれたボボアさんに深い感謝を。
Yeah, so in today's race, honestly, I think it was my mistakes that had the biggest effect to our race overall. So you know, I'm really thankful to Bobo for you know, really covering for me and you know, and trying to make up for my mistakes.
Well, great to hear from the three drivers from Mercedes AMG. Let's move over to Team Toyota, to the three drivers, Nikita Moisov, to Igor Fraga, and of course to Ryota Kokoban. First of all, let's go to Igor. Igor, an incredible final stint for you there. You really tried as hard as you could. Just talk us through your emotions after Team Toyota finishing second.
Yeah, first of all, we are very proud as a team. Since the beginning of the season, probably we are the most consistent team, I think. We didn't make any mistakes through the season. We only had one round, which was the round two, that we had the fastest car. But all the other rounds, all car was kind of okay. But yeah, it was very difficult. But the strength of the team was very good, and we were always able to capitalize good points, which were made it possible to fight until the end of the championship. Oka also was not great at the rain, but yeah, nobody did a mistake. We could fight until the end. It was just the strategy was that was not the best. That was the toughest part. It kind of hurts a little bit that we were so close. We were at the same point. But at the same time, we were. I am very proud as a team, and I'm very thankful to have them together this year.
Igor, thank you very much. Ryota, let's just get your emotions. Just talk us through how you're feeling about your input on Team Toyota finishing second.
じゃあ国分選手、今回 の, あのレースで の, あのチームへの貢献、自分の貢献について今 の, あの、感想をお願いします。
はい。まずレース1で最初のスティントを担当したのですが、無事に6周を終えて後の周回をチームメイトに託すことができてよかったです。グランドファイナルではインターミディエイトを使いましたが、車を最後までピットに運ぶということを考えて走りました。ミスをしないという意味ではチームに貢献できたのかなと思います。
Yeah, so you know, for the first stint, I was really just focused on getting through those six laps and getting the car, you know, safely back to the pits. And I think you know, for the grand final as well, you know, we started on the intermediates, and it was, you know, my mission to get the car safely back to the pits and pass it on to the other drivers. And I was able to do that, you know, without making mistakes. So I'm pretty satisfied.
Rioto, thank you very much. And Nikita, let's just talk to you about Toyota finishing in second. Of course, you were in the stints on the hard compound of tyres where the track was dry. So just talk us through what the car was like to drive and how you feel about the second place result.
First of all, big congratulations to Team Subaru for winning these championships. They really did a good job with the strategy, especially. They chose the right tire, and that really benefited them. And also, congratulations to Team Mercedes for finishing P3 in the championship. I think no one expected it, to be honest. And also, thank you to my teammates for an amazing and consistent season, just as Igor said. Yeah, my stint was basically not to make any mistakes, as the track was drying up. It was crucial to stay on the dry line and not to use the wet patches on the track. So yeah, it was easy to make a mistake, like you saw Porsche spinning out just because they clipped the curb on the outside. So yeah, it was really crucial to not make mistakes.
Nikita, thank you very much, and congratulations to Team Toyota for finishing second. We now come over to our Manufacturers Cup champions of 2022, to Takuma Miyazono, to Danny Solis, and of course to Killian Drumont. Killian, let's start of all, first of all, with you, because of course you took Subaru to the checkered flag. Just talk us through your emotions, and of course, congratulations.
Bon, Kylian, déjà félicitations pour cette première place. Est-ce que tu pourrais nous donner un petit peu tes émotions et ce que tu ressens maintenant que tu es passé premier?
First of all, I congratulate Mercedes for his very good battle all the years, and I'm very very happy for versus you under the seasons. And Toyota is very other competitors, because all of the seasons he back before Monaco, equal points, and yeah. But my emotions now, right now, I have so much emotions, because yesterday I didn't qualify for the big finals Nations Cup. Now I'm feeling more better. So yeah, a lot of emotions I don't believe. So yeah. It's too much for me. Sorry.
Well, Killian, many congratulations. Takuma, again, you're part, of course, of the winning team. I know you said in the post-race interview with Julia that you were upset at some of the mistakes that you've made, but, of course, I imagine you must be thrilled at bringing home a second title for Subaru in the Manufacturers' Cup.
Hi, Miyazono senshu. レース後 の, あのインタビューの中ではちょっと自分のミスが影響があったことをちょっと悔いていたようなコメントをいただきましたけど、でも最終的にはこうやって勝利を2度目のスバルの勝利を上げることができて今 の, 感想をお願いします。
はい、今年は本当に、いろんなことがあって、まずショーダウンが、体調不良でちょっと欠席になったんですけど、そこでダニエルとキリアの2人が優勝してくれて、すごいポイントを稼いでくれましたし、僕としては第一戦で優勝できたというところが貢献できたポイントかなというふうには思っているんですけど、本当にシーズン通してキリアンとダニエルの2人に引っ張ってもらった上でのこのチャンピオンだと思うので、本当に2人に本当に感謝しています。
Yeah, so you know, I think a lot happened this year. You know, for the showdown event, I was sick and I was not able to race, but you know, Daniel and Killian pulled it off, and you know, they got points for us in the race. I think I contributed in achieving first, the first race. But you know, throughout the season, it was really Killian and Daniel that pulled me through and pulled the team through to our victories. So I'm very thankful to them.
Takuma, congratulations. And finally, we come to Danny Solis. Danny, we saw the emotion of you when Subaru crossed the line. Of course, you've been a part of the success with the World Series Showdown and, of course, now here as you become champions. Just talk us through how you're feeling.
Okay, I want to say, is this thing on? First off, congratulations to the whole podium. I'm literally sat at a table full of people that I just respect so much for their talent. These are all super great people. But, you know, it's funny because when we came into this day, we were a little bit worried. We didn't think that we were going to do too well because of how our car was at Deep Forest. And so to be able to come out with a win, especially with Killian's result in Nations, he said, let's win this today. And so we came and won it. So, I mean, it's amazing. I'm over the moon. And, of course, in 2020, I won online. And so it was a bit of an empty feeling. So to be able to come back to a live event and do it here is amazing. So I'm really happy.
Danny, thank you very much. I'd now like to open it up to questions from the floor.
Thank you. Sylvain Gauthier for Automoto. Question to Team Subaru. How and when did you decide to put wet tires instead of inters?
Subaru のチームへの質問なんですけど、あのいつどの時点で、あのインターミディテートではなくてウェットタイヤをつけようと決めたんでしょうか。
So we were sat there waiting forever. Like, are we going to get rain? Like, we need rain to get in this race. And I looked over at Killian and I told him, he was asking what tire we should do. And I said, well, we can't catch up if we do intermediates. So I think we have to go heavy wets because there's no other way we get back into this race. And then we deliberated back and forth, all three of us, for a little bit. And we almost went intermediate, but I told him, like, no, we got to do wets because it's our only chance. And we started the rain on intermediate conditions. So in my head, it only made sense that the wets would come into play later. So we made that call, and then it was the right call, apparently. But, as soon as the rain started coming down, it's just the right time to make it in.
Tom from traction.gg. Congratulations to everybody here on an amazing season. You've all done really well. I've got a quick question for Danny again, if that's okay. What does it mean to you to win a second World Series title along with your teammates? And also, what is it about this competition that keeps you coming back for more?
So winning a second time is really nice, like I said, especially because this is my first one at a live event. But it's doubly as good because, again, we came into it not expecting to do very well. And so, I mean, it's a good feeling. We had some pretty lucky races, so that helped a bit. Like, if the pack hadn't made the mistakes that they did in the Deep Forest race, maybe we would have dropped down to like sixth or something, and that would have cost us it. But, you know, everything worked out in the end. And as for what keeps me coming back, I mean, it's all this. Being able to come out here, see all my friends play, and just have some fun. Obviously, I want to win, but for me, first and foremost, it's just having fun and not trying to put pressure on myself so that I can just enjoy the experience. And that's what happened. So,
any further questions from the floor?
Question de Cédric Ruiz, Radio France. Question pour Kylian. Bravo en tout cas pour la compétition. Est-ce que tu sais que pendant que toi tu devenais champion du monde, la France gagnait avec un but de Kylian? On a deux Kylian du coup, champion du monde. Qu'est-ce que ça te fait?
I'm going to translate very quick. So, a question for Kylian. So, why you were driving and winning today at the same time the French soccer team was winning in the World Cup? Two scores, two goals from Kylian Mbappé. So, two Kylians on the high road today. How do you feel about that?
I'm feeling really good because two wins and two the same time, so it's really good. Good, Okay. C'est vraiment cool de savoir que la France a gagné. Et bah, ce soir aussi, on a gagné avec Subaru et la France a gagné aussi en Coupe du Monde. Donc, bah, c'est vraiment une bonne nouvelle aussi. Et ça que peut embellir ma soirée pour aujourd'hui. Donc, ouais. Et mes émotions, bah, j'en ai beaucoup trop. C'est indescriptible, je pense, pour les décrire maintenant. Donc, peut-être demain, je pourrais vous le dire. Mais là, c'est beaucoup trop. Merci.
So it's very good. It's very cool to see that French soccer team also won today. It's a very, very good news. I have too many emotions right now. So please talk to me tomorrow. I can tell you more.
Wonderful. I think that's the end of the questions from the floor. We have a few questions in from social media. First of all, to Team Subaru, and you can decide amongst yourselves who answers this question. But what was it that made you decide that the full wet gamble would work? And also, congratulations to all of the drivers.
決定的に、もう、じゃあウェットで行こうっていう決めた理由というか、決めてだったのはどういった要因だったんでしょうかと。で、誰が答えても大丈夫です。はい。僕がハードのスティント担当してたんですけど、最後の方に、ちょっと雨が降ってきて、ピットに入るというタイミングで、キリアンの方から、 ウェットにするというふうに無線で入ってきて、で、僕もそうするべきだと思っていたので、じゃあ分かったというふうに言って、本当にそのピットに入った週にウェットにするっていう決断は決まったのかなと思います。はい。Yeah,
so I was doing the stint, my stint on the hards. At the pit timing, Killian had said we should go on the wet on the radio. I was thinking the exact same thing, so it was really on the pit lap that we decided, to go with the heavy wets.
Wonderful, thank you very much. A question for the Toyota drivers, and again, you can decide amongst you who answers this question. Which tyre choice do you think was it that cost you the win at Spa-Francorchamps? Do you think it was the full wets at the start of the race or the intermediates in the second pit stop?
Most likely was at the beginning with the intermediates. At the practice before the race start, we could see a little bit how the condition at the start of the race was going to look like. It was starting with, like, I don't know, 30% of rain, 30 to 40%. And it was increasing slowly, so we thought, like, it was maybe better to be safe. But at the end, like, it didn't went up so high. And yeah, I think we lost probably like 4 to 5 seconds. I mean, as our car was also not the fastest, so we probably wouldn't be able to stay with the Porsche anyways. But definitely we could have gained more time. And also another place that we could have gained more time was when I asked Kokubun-san to pit in. It probably would have been better one lap earlier, because we were losing pace at that point as well. So, yeah, it was most likely those two places.
Igor, thank you very much. And one final question to all of the three teams. We'll go in reverse order from Mercedes to Toyota to then Subaru. First of all, to Mercedes, it's a question asking about the changeable weather. How did you find the changeable weather in the Manufacturers' Cup Grand Final? Was it something that you enjoyed the variable of?
じゃあ、3チームへの質問なんですけど、まずは逆順に、メルセデスから聞きします。こういった天候変化、GTのチャンピオンシップに導入されて、それについて感想をお願いしますと。どなたが答えても大丈夫だと思いますけど。そうですね。天候変化については、実際のレースのように、 慎重さが求められるので、そういったところは今までの天候変化がないレースと違って集中する必要があったので、路面の状況をしっかりと見て判断して走るのが必要だったので、だいぶ 面白いというか、そうですね、結構難しいと思いましたけど、僕はとても楽しいと思いました。
So, you know, having the weather changes implemented, you know, really puts you in a condition like in a real world race where, you know, you have to be, you know, very careful, you know, and you have to make sure that you're focused and you're really watching the surface conditions, you know, and when you're racing. I think, it, you know, it makes it, you know, interesting, but also very difficult. But in the end, I think it was it's very fun to have that element.
Thank you very much. Let's move that question over to Team Toyota. We'll go to Nikita for this question. Nikita, did you enjoy the added challenge of mixed weather in the race?
Oh yeah, for sure. It was something different, something we didn't really experience before, and it was great to see so many different strategies and all the manufacturers battling it out on track.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Nikita. And we'll pass that question over to Team Subaru as well. Danny, we'll get you to answer this question just for the last one. What are your thoughts on the mixed weather for the grand final?
I think it was a lot of fun, and it made it interesting because we had to figure out the right strategy. Just don't ask Lexus. Their car, they didn't like it, so don't ask them. But for the rest of us, I think we all thought it was pretty fun. It's always nice to have a little bit of variable in the races because, you know, we're so used to just nothing but dry racing all out all the time. So, I think it's a lot of fun. It's a little scary, but, you know, uncharted territory is always fun. So it's exciting.
Well, that does bring an end to the press conference here for the World Finals of the Manufacturers' Cup. Then a huge congratulations to third place to Team Mercedes-AMG of Baptiste Beauvoir, of Lucas Benelli, and of Shinsuke Saboy. To second place for Team Toyota of Nikita Moisov, of Igor Fraga, and of Ryota Kokoburn. And, of course, to our Manufacturers' Cup champions of 2022 of Takuma Miyazono, to Killian Drumont, and to Danny Solis of Team Subaru. We, of course, are back for more racing action here tomorrow for the Nations Cup Grand Finals, and we will be live at 5 p.m. local time for that. But in the meantime, thank you very much, and once again, a huge congratulations to our top three finishers in the Manufacturers' Cup.